What's up and welcome back to the Section 10 Podcast, episode 462, presented by Underdog Fantasy. It is the home of your 10-10 last place Boston Red Sox. My name is Jared Carabas, and I am a certified G and a bona fide stud, and you can't teach that. And this right here, this is Coley Mick, and he's 7 foot tall, and you can't teach that. And this right here, this is Tyler Milliken, and he killed his dog Bullet, and you can't teach that. Bada boom, realest guys in the room. Steve, how you doing?
What up, Section 10 in the building?
In the motherfucking building. The season's over. I'm calling it.
Thank you, Red Sox Nation.
Thank you, Red Sox Nation.
Suck
this
one.
Season is cooked. Presented by Blue Moon. The season is cooked. The season's cooked. I'm sorry if that hurt. I mean, if you're listening to this, you already know that. All the bad things in the world happen to us. Trevor Story's done for the year. Rafael Devers is getting MRIs on his knee. Tyler O'Neill's on the injured list. Garrett Whitlock's on the injured list. Nick Pivetta's on the injured list. Lucas Giolito's out for the year. I mean, listen. We're going to talk about that Tanner Houck complete game shout-out. You bet your ass we're going to talk about that. We're going to get into the notebook. We're going to talk about these games that took place. But I'll say this. As someone that watches every...
Death. Dying.
My allergies are killing me. The last 2 days, I've just been toast.
Fuck yeah.
I've watched every single baseball game, I mean, pretty much forever, but like more specifically when we're looking at the last couple of years here. Last year, you know, we probably got to maybe the All-Star break, maybe a little bit after that before the games made you feel like, all right, it's over. Like, I'm not emotionally invested anymore. This year, I mean, like, I don't know how you guys feel. Maybe I'm just being a negative Nancy, but like, for example, in the series finale, and we'll get like usually we go in order, but like the first line of my notes for the series finale is this has to be the worst lineup I've ever seen. Like,
it doesn't get much worse than that. Yeah.
Steve had the tweet that went viral. It's like the collective payroll of the fucking entire lineup was like $8.
I think it was $8.99. Yeah. It's Joe Kelly is making more this year than the entire Red Sox lineup in the
finale. What was it? 7.9 million?
7.9 for the Sox lineup. Joe Kelly, 8 million.
7.9 million for the entire fucking lineup that they put out there today. But more so speaking to my feeling of like, I mean, I can't fake it because I talked to Maz about this on the baseball hour, on Wednesday night. And we were talking about Cora. And I was like, I feel like he's also a guy that just can't fake it. Like, if he doesn't believe it, then he's not going to give you the rah-rah speech. He's just going to be like, it is what it is. The roster is the roster. Like, that's kind of where I'm at right now as a fan is when the Red Sox, when it got to 5-4 in the ninth inning, Casas was up. I don't even think, like, I couldn't fake, like, man. You know, if he gets a hold of one right here and ties it in the bottom of the ninth, like, I'm going to jump off my couch. Like, I couldn't fake it. I was just like, I don't think anything's going to happen right here. I don't believe in this team. I don't believe in this team. Coley, do you disagree?
No, it was like, I'm trying to think when I get excited about this team. And when Durant hit that gap shot today, I jumped up because I was like, he might go inside the park here. But he's slow and fat, so he only got a triple. But yeah, this—it's not even like one of these guys is particularly interesting. Like, I want to really like Valdez, and I think he would have hit a home run in June today. But since it was rainy in April, it was just not even warning track power. Laureano caught it in like his back pocket. Abreu. That guy's unbelievable. As long as the ball's hit in the air, if it's hit on the ground, he's got no shot. As at bats, he'll take a walk with the best of them. He's the only one trying to keep this Take Sox thing alive. But like the whole outside of Duran and Casas, I don't expect anything from anybody when they dig into, like, not a single thing. And Rafael is the only one I don't even care about because I know how elite he is defensively. And, like, the most well-known thing about him was, like, hey, hitting is going to be a wild ride at best. He's probably just not going to be ever very good at it. And he's just kind of done that. He's proven exactly that point so far. So everyone else is just like, are you a piece? No, it doesn't look like it. Connor Wong, I don't want to disrespect Connor Wong. He's given us something to watch. But even when I look at him, I'm like, you're not Mookie Betts. So I still kind of hate you.
I can't remember a Red Sox lineup like the finale where you got to the three spot in the order. It's like, all right, we're going to have to, you know, it's got to get around. It's got to get back to the top because this is already at like the eight spot. Willie Abreu in the three hole. Who's done better? Still hitting 184. Yeah,
who thought we trade Christian Vasquez that you were getting your future 3-4 hitters in that fucking trade?
Yeah, exactly. They got the harder lineup for half a year or 2 months of Christian Vasquez.
Like, the truth is, Emmanuel Valdez wouldn't even be on this team if Vaughn Grissom was healthy. That's the guy who's holding down that spot in the lineup. And Willie Abreu, who you were going away from at the start of the season and you've completely come back with, he's getting everyday at bats against right-handers. Like, watching a stupid baseball team is the most painful thing you can do. It's one thing if you're just not very talented. All right,
David Hamilton was hitting sixth today.
Just not a big league ball player in any capacity.
None of these guys.
It was the Woo Sox lineup today.
Oh my God, dude. Like, fucking. Well,
the killer's Devers. I mean, understandable. It's multiple things. O'Neal,
you want to talk about killers, Steve? How about the fact that fucking Masataka Yoshida is so bad that he's getting benched? Like, he's getting benched. He's so bad.
No, I know the Yoshida thing sucks too, but every single day it's a new report on Devers.
He got fucking benched in a game that Devers was out of the lineup. That's bad too.
And also a
guy
you were
glaringly bad.
Yeah, you were slipping him in your lineup at 3-4 just a couple days ago before that. That's how desperate you are for anyone to get going.
It's still the Rafi thing's been tough, where it's, oh, he felt good today, but then he didn't feel great the next day. And oh, we're gonna get him MRI. Oh, he's not going to the IL. It's like, if we're going to start somewhere, that's where I'm starting because he should be the face of your lineup. Then he's also the guy that rams into Tyler O'Neill, and now he's out.
I can't have that be the narrative. If we're going to get on Rafael Devers for his defense, I'm sure as shit not going to chirp him when he catches the ball.
He did catch the ball.
I'm just saying, it's not a monster.
He caught the ball.
When that also
caught the ball. The guy running and can see him should have avoided him.
The outfielder typically hats his ball. They're both saying, I got it. So
O'Neal's a two-time Gold Glove winner. Get the fuck out of his way. Move.
He caught the ball.
Good for him. Get out the way.
On, Jake.
Caught the ball.
Caught the ball. Yeah.
He did catch the ball, but still.
Devers caught the ball. Also, Alex Cora was asked about it after the game, and he was like, he caught the ball.
I mean, he 100% caught the ball. There's no denying that.
I would also argue it's not the left fielder's ball. It's the shortstop's ball, but it was the only game this year, unless I'm forgetting one, where Rafaela was playing short. He sure as shit can't call off either of them.
I know. Yeah, then it becomes a seniority thing where it's like, I'm not getting away. This is my first game playing here. So, yeah, I mean, no, I'm not making a whole thing out of the collision. Those are two guys going for the ball, and it's honestly just unlucky timing. But if we're talking with this lineup, I mean, Devers has done next to nothing. That's why I was so excited about that hit in game two, where it's like, oh my God, he actually got a huge hit. And his reaction at second base was like filling in for all the lack of production he's had all year. He was doing the monster thing like times 10. And then, you know, we'll get to Kenley, I'm sure, but blowing that sucks. This should be a Benny's Banana split. We should be having splits right now.
We should be having splitting it up.
That's what upsets me.
What's Benny's Banana splits slogan?
Choke it down your throat hole.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Well, we're not getting a Benny's Banana split, unfortunately.
No, and they honestly don't deserve it. Like, that would have felt like such a coup to take two off the Guardians. Like, you load the bases, since we've started with this game, you load the bases. What do they have, one out when they loaded the bases in the first today? They scored a grand total of one run. Stinks.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. I mean, the first game of the series feels like a lifetime ago because the first line in the notes, April 15th, 2024 versus the Guardians, game number 17 of the season. We are blessed. Devers is back. Rafaela at short. That's the first line. Will your Abreu catch it?
Electric.
I'll repeat it because you're all everyone's internet went out.
Yeah.
All of ours.
We are blessed. Devers is back. Rafaela at short. It really felt like, you know, nature is healing.
That's the
it
best.
It didn't work
lineup
out that way.
Yeah, that's the best lineup you can possibly field. And I will say, Cora today, I think, started to show you after the game that they want to go back to that, where he was like, listen, the injuries are what the injuries are, but Rafael is going to get a shot at shortstop again. You hope you can kind of go that way. But now with even Devers' whole language today kind of went against what Cora said after the game, where Cora's like, yeah, you know, he doesn't need an IL stint. He should be good. Devers is like, no, I'm going to take things slow. I need to make sure I'm okay here. Maybe an IL stint is on the table.
Why not just go to the IL at this point, right?
If it's going
to be this every other day thing, they can't afford him in there either. If he's hitting like 150.
Well, but that's, Steve, you go back to game two and he has that hit, you go, okay, all right.
I know he technically can do that. It's just
reached base three times
a series.
Three times in that game, he went 1-for-4 in the first game of the series. So he started. Now you're talking a different injury with the knee. All right, if his fielding is going to get even worse, then it's a different conversation. But that's how thin the line is for this team. They cannot possibly exist without Rafael Devers in it, even if it is 3 or 4 days a week right now. If they want to clink to even an ounce of trying to be somewhat competitive, that's it. If he's out for 2 or 3 weeks, you will be completely out of this race by then. You will most likely lose 5-6 games a week.
Let's worry about tomorrow. We can't be worrying about races.
No, tomorrow. But in general, if we're talking this lineup for 3 weeks straight, how many games do you think you're going to win over 3 weeks?
None.
That's it.
None.
You'll lose all.
It'll
of
be
them.
Over. And at the end of the day, in April, you may not win anything, but you can completely be out of it, and you're not going to win anything no matter what this year. That's the reality of it. You're not even going to be competitive probably by May, but you'll get there a lot quicker.
But strange, they're 10-10. If we knew they'd be 10-10 before the season, we'd say that sounds about right. But it's the path they took to 10-10 that's really bought. Like, they should probably be
18-2.
Yeah, exactly.
It should be 17-3, maybe.
I was going to say 13-7, 14-6 feel realistic
Ball
with how the season
Detmer's goes. Losses, like, we've just got nothing for that guy. I'm convinced he's the best pitcher in the league. And then what we got smacked by the Corbin Burns game. Like, those are the three games we got our dicks handed to us. Every other game,
was Detmer's also again. There was one like opening day we lost 7-0, and then there was like a seven.
That was the Burns game.
Yeah, 7-0. That was the Burns game. But then I think that there was an Angels game that was like 7-1.
The Detmer's
got
game.
Our dicks.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah. Okay. Yeah. Then Detmer's. And Burns, that's it. We should have won every other game.
Correct.
Yeah, 3 out of 20 of the games are like, okay, those are losses. But the other 17 are all winnable. Wins. Not going to say you're going to win all of them, but... Yeah.
Isn't that the game we played last year? Like, that's the exact game we played last year where we sat there and said, hey, if Kike Hernandez didn't make this error, this is what the record would be. Ultimately, this is what you are. And your organization and team clearly doesn't care enough to keep running David Hamilton out there. No matter what, it's not even fair to him at this point. The poor fucking guy, do you see how hard he has to throw to first base to get the ball there? Like, he's crow hopping multiple times to get the ball to first base. This is strictly like an ability problem, and they have no problem letting him go out there and embarrass himself. You could go sign Elvis Andrews just to fucking get by. Do something, anything but that. But you're going to run out a kid who clearly is well above his head and is such a mental mess, he can't even touch the bag anymore. He's missing the bag. He's making such little mental mistakes that no professional baseball player should make it any level.
He is great at missing the bag. I'll give him that. He's one of the best miss the bag guys we've ever seen.
I've never seen anything like it. He's the best.
Where does the blame go? Where does the blame go for Hamilton? I see people blaming Cora.
His feet, because then he misses the base with his feet.
If he had stepped on it, then we wouldn't be talking about the feet. But he has to step on it with his feet.
The toes.
Mm-hmm.
Step on them with your feet.
Got to do
That's
it.
What you got to do?
Oh, you can use your hands too. Like they Reese. Really just want you to touch them.
Yeah,
just touch them.
Just
That's
touch
it.
Them. Like when you hit a home run, they say touch them all. If you miss one of them, you don't get the home run. Doesn't matter how far you hit the ball. Just gotta touch.
Imagine
them.
David Hamilton just like fields a ground ball at shortstop, runs over and slaps second base.
Listen.
And
I couldn't even imagine the first half of your scenario.
Fields it? Fields the ground ball? What the hell is that all about?
Tyler, to answer your question, ownership. The answer is always ownership. That's the only person to blame is ownership.
Yes. I mean, just in terms of David Hamilton playing there right now, though, do you think that ownership. Is a front office decision to say we believe in David Hamilton to be able to be there?
No.
Or do you
no.
think that's Cora running the Kike Hernandez play?
No one could possibly believe in David, and not David Hamilton's parents, relatives,
no.
God himself, who created David Hamilton's, like, this was a mistake.
Yeah, it was not. I mean, it has not been a fun process.
First at bat was electric.
Yeah, the home run was sick.
Unbelievable. Yeah,
Cutter Crawford, 5 2/3. 92 pitches, 2 hits. 0 earned runs, 0 walks, 6 strikeouts. His ERA is down to 0.42.
He was honoring Jackie. 0.42 yeah. on Jackie mm-hmm. Robinson Day.
Yep. Of course, this start was completely wasted. Greg Weissert breaking my balls. This was the Will Brennan 2-run home run to make it 2-0 Guardians in the 7th. Devers and O'Neill may be dead. O'Neill bleeding after collision. Devers is alive. O'Neill maybe still dead, mm-hmm. which ultimately we know now he is.
Yeah.
Weren't we originally told he would be back in the lineup today, and then today was the day that we found out he's going on the injured list?
Sounds
they
right.
said they were going to give him at least a day or two, and then he's now, you know, apparently he cleared concussion protocols, but 2 days later he has a concussion.
Well, did you not hear what he was saying?
He has
you
brain
say he
fog.
He wants to be back Tuesday?
No, he cleared Tuesday. Concussion protocol, but then when they asked him about it today, he was like, yeah, I've been like super dizzy. Like, he's just describing a concussion.
Latest I saw was that he wants to play for the next Guardian series after the Pirates.
Yeah, he's on the 7-day IL, which is just for concussions. So he should be available by the 23rd because they dated it back to the 16th. Yeah.
Yep. Yeah. More shitty defense. Guardians score 2 runs on a ground ball to first base. 4-0 in the 8th. Chase Anderson is this team's big piece. What?
I feel like Chase has been better than big piece, but I don't know. I don't have the numbers in front of me. Go ahead.
No, they've been it's the same thing.
Big piece was sneaky very good that first month of April, and then he just went so downhill it was ridiculous. But they were low-key leaning on him early on in that season. There was like a 2-week stretch.
Chase Anderson.
When they signed him, they were like, he's going to play every position for us. He's this is the future of the Red Sox.
This is the future. This is the way.
Chase Anderson also hasn't taught anyone a pitch yet. So
no, I was thinking about that while I was talking. So it remains to be seen what Chase really brings to the club.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. Red Sox get 3 hit and a shutout. It was a 6-0 loss.
Mm-hmm.
J-Dog. So I did love Cora purposely making a point to call out David Hamilton on that Jose Ramirez ball that went into the outfield. Abreu got charged with the error, the throwing error coming in, which, you know, he came in rifling and he was like 10 feet away. But he did mention David Hamilton can't basically pick the ball whatsoever. So please keep giving me that. 3 errors in 10 games. He's on pace for 48 this season.
That's not bad, right?
Horrendous. Worst ever.
Yeah.
Yeah, like that's worse than Julio Lugo.
R.I.P.
He was bad. R.I.P. Not to speak ill of the dead, but I mean, he was pretty bad.
Last guy to take Pedro deep.
Yeah, I was there.
That's true. Mm-hmm. Why did they stop doing that? The alumni game.
They brought it back. Idea. They were like, yeah, we used to do this back in the 80s. Let's bring it back. And they brought it back for one game. And they Julio Lugo hit a home run off Pedro. And they were like, shut it the fuck down.
No more. Well, Pedro probably went to him like, guys, come on. We're not doing that.
Yeah, if you want Pedro to pitch in the game, then no more Julio Lugo. Shut it down. All right. Game 2. Will Brennan is this series Colton Cowser. RBI double, 1-0 in the 2nd inning. Why the fuck is Tristan Casas trying to steal third base with nobody out?
Buddy.
Was so bad.
Buddy.
Cora was ready to die. That look on Cora's face was the most depressed look and confused look I've
ever
seen.
I thought he might hit him. I thought he was looking at him like, when you get here, I'm gonna punch you, and I have every right to do it.
What was the deal with that?
Listen.
Like, that's not a missed sign. That's just like a, hey, he's that third baseman's not really covering third base. I bet I can beat him there.
when you're
Jose was looking right at him.
He Uncle Rico'd it. He was like, I bet you I can fucking run faster than that guy.
I'm gonna take. I think he was safe if he didn't slide past the bag.
Coley's 100% right. 100%.
It's
look at the replay. I'm not defending his action at all by any means. It was
sounds like you're defending it.
No, big dumb brain decision. He did beat him. He just slid. He had so much speed. He went right past the bag. And Jose Ramirez, since he's good at baseball, kept holding the tag and also caught the ball while running. Like, we couldn't have, if teams did that against us, they would score every time. If they tried to steal third on us, it would just be constant free runs. Steve?
I remember the end of my baseball career was JV. I got like two hits all year, and when I'd make contact, which was rare, I thought I was cooking it down the line. Like, you, when you're really running, you think you're going. And then everyone in the dugout's like, you might be the slowest runner I've ever seen in my life. I think Casas, he's lighter. He's lost some LBs. I think he's like, you know what? That bag's my bag. I am going to take that. I'm going to get in score, not just scoring position, sack fly position with no outs. Everyone's going to be cheering my name. And it was one of the dumbest decisions of the season so far. Cora wanted to kill him. And even, I mean, credit to him after the game. He was like, it was very poor judgment and it was a low IQ baseball play. He took blame for it. Cora said there's no excuse. He knows it. He just took off. We cannot push the envelope that way. We cannot do it. That's the bottom line. 27 outs are too valuable in this game. It's one of the dumbest base running decisions I've seen. But then again, it fits right into the Red Sox plan to be one of the worst base running teams of all time.
Nothing will ever be worse than Jeff Suppan.
Oh, right. Series?
Getting hosed by Poppy, right.
Mm-hmm. He didn't know what was going on.
No. No. Poppy knew what was going on.
The Cardinals, that whole series, like Suppan and Marquis were on the bags constantly that series. They were always using those pinch runners.
Yep.
Tyler, you had something there?
No, just you lead the league right now and caught stealing. And then
Tyler,
you
got something?
Tyler?
Hello?
Tyler had something. Yeah, Tyler, you had something. Tyler.
Go ahead.
Fuck you guys. Fuck you.
Tyler, you got a new sign, dude?
Coley?
Nope, Tyler's got a sign.
Let's see the sign.
Matt Cote.
For our audio listeners, it is a sign.
Section 10 sign. I hung it up high on my wall, but I realized when we started that you couldn't see it in the camera.
He also put it on his bed before we started the podcast and then sat down. And we were like, we can't see it at all. Like, it was just behind him, completely blocked. I think you should hold it for the whole pod.
Yeah.
There's a string.
Yeah, I'm hanging around your neck.
It won't fit.
Make it a necklace, dude.
If he wore that thing as a necklace for the entire show.
It'd be like the old like stocks that they used to put prisoners in the middle of town square with like their arms and head. Yeah.
He looks like the dude that's like trying to flag people down to go to the car wash.
Yeah, you gotta be flipping it and shit.
Yeah.
Twirl that thing.
Yeah, there you go. Yeah, that's right. Yep.
But yeah, as a lumbering oaf myself, I definitely can relate to being like, I am the fastest man alive. And then it just being proven completely, even if he's safe there, people are still like, why the fuck? You're our only, like, you're one of our two watchable players right now. If you had gotten hurt doing that, like, I used to hate when Ortiz would steal, especially like the second half of his career in Toronto, he'd be taken off. It's like, this is the worst possible surface to be trying this shit on, pal. Knock it off.
I honestly thought of Coley when that happened. I was like, and no disrespect, Coley, this is in the most respectful way. I was like, if Coley tried to steal third, it would probably look like that. Like, he's 7 feet tall, and it took him a while to get going. He's like, all right, here we go. We're going. He was almost doing a crow hop to get going, to get momentum. It's like, the pitcher's looking at you.
He got a bad jump. He's looking at you. He got a bad, like, none of it was in his favor. Absolutely none of it.
But Jose Ramirez was stunned. He's like, oh my God, he's actually going to try to steal third right here. And then the tag. I got to watch it again. I didn't know that he would have been safe. I got to watch the replay.
That feels made up.
No, he was shocked when I saw
it. He would have been safe, really?
He was on. He made it to the bag because he's so large of a human. He made it to the bag first. But all of his momentum just took him right into the Guardians dugout. So he was super out.
Yeah.
Valdez hitting 167, pimping homers.
Fine with it.
Made 2-1. 2-1 Guardians in the fourth. Whitlock is cooked. Four innings, 54 pitches, three hits, two earned, one walk. one strikeout. Anything to say for yourself, T-Doc? This was your fault.
It's an oblique injury. What do you want from me? He tried to fight it. I give him credit. They put him on the IL, and he was like, I don't need to go on. I can pitch through it. Obviously, the Red Sox are being careful. It's not elbow, so I'm not going to freak out. An oblique's an oblique.
Yeah, yeah, sure. This is your fault. This is your fault, yep.
You don't think he injures his oblique if he's a reliever?
Cole?
We know whose fault it is. All of the Red Sox problems are one person's fault. And it's Liam Fennessy. It's all
that's true.
Liam's fault.
Yeah. Yeah, Liam, listen. One of the best Red Sox fans to ever do it. Okay?
He's great.
Love Liam. Known him for a long time. Been a fan on Twitter for a long time. He can't be going to these games. Yeah. Can't be going to these games. And I have it on good authority that he has plans to go in the future. That can't happen.
Nope.
Cannot happen.
What's his living situation? Do we know? Is it girlfriend? We just got to let someone know you can't let this guy leave the place to go to the game. Can't
happen. Right. Yeah. Well, I mean, we can probably get in touch with security.
Okay. Definitely. But he was in Seattle.
That's true.
This guy loves going to the
games. This guy's fucking menace.
When you love going to the games, it's hard to not go.
Guy's just flying across the country to try and sabotage the season.
It's crazy. He might be on Henry's payroll the more we're talking about it.
Oh, yeah.
Yeah.
Fantasy was probably at the funeral on behest of John Henry.
By the 100%. Way, breaking news from Steve Peralt. Mm-hmm. Like, John Henry was at Fenway like the day after he said he was too sick to go to the fucking funeral.
He looked so not sick.
Oh, he was healthy as fuck, dude.
Oh, my God. Not a single cough. Healthy, I didn't see him do the. Didn't see any sniffles. Nothing.
Nothing.
Stood the whole
nothing.
Game.
Nothing.
Yep.
Nothing.
Eating,
he
drinking,
was like running in
great.
Place. Yeah.
Yep.
Respiratory system was perfect.
Mm.
I've never seen someone take more crisp breath than him.
Dude, he was breathing good Marathon Monday.
There was nothing stopping him from getting oxygen in those lungs. Mm-hmm. Nothing.
Yeah.
So healthy.
Get Jolie's bum ass off the team. Freeman home run makes 3-1 in the fifth. Two more hits. Sac fly 4-1 Cleveland in the fifth. Another hit. Willier E9 5-1. Like, it's just, it's, come on. Come on.
At least
T-Dog?
For
you
Willier.
You defend Jolie?
No. Fucking Joel Ellie Rodriguez, you think I'm going to do it? But I will say, Willier and Tristan Casas did something. They did something at least to make up for their errors. Abreu saves the game from, you know, completely going downhill in 9 innings in the ninth. Casas hits a homer. Like, we'll get to Kenley, but God, what the fuck did he do to help anybody? At least those two guys stepped up to keep you in the game.
Listen, if Casas doesn't get thrown off second, Kenley just lets up his one run and they go home with a dub.
Get the fucking job done.
That's how the math works.
A year. Please, you're going to let Tyler Freeman, who has a fucking sub-700 OPS, the number 9 hitter, hit a double off you, and Joely Rodriguez is also going to let Freeman take him deep. That's what we're doing?
Sounds like he's
be
hitting.
Better me. Be fucking better.
Be hitting cleanup for the Sox with those numbers.
God, like we're not getting number 9 hitters out. Instead, we're letting them hit nukes off us. Can't do it. Refuse to do it.
Won't
He's
do
not going to do it.
I forgive you, Tristan. Home run 5-2 in the six guards. Bang the gong. It's a 2-run Wong Dong 5-4 guards. Raffy deserves all the ice cream. 2-run double 6-5 Sox in the sixth. And then I said, mark my words, Kenley will blow this.
Oh, for sure.
Next line, he blew it. 6-6 in the ninth.
Cole.
But before we get to the Kenley stuff, both the times Devers has gotten hurt has been after his big hits. The home run in Seattle immediately hurt, and then this double hurt again. I don't know if that's coincidence. I don't know if it's causation doesn't equal correlation, shit like that. But it seems like when he's put the most torque on the ball thus far this season, he hasn't been able to play the very next day.
That makes sense. He has a very violent swing.
Sure, but he's been able to do that up to this point in his career, which is like, they aren't even the same injury. It's been shoulder, it's been knee, but I don't love that every time he has a big hit, he then can't play for at least like 48 hours.
Yeah. T-Dog?
Is this more of a curse you're worried about, Coley? Like, no, you get the big swing and then it happens? Or are you worried that his body legit can't take him swinging that hard?
No, I don't even think it's like a long-term problem. I think whatever the issue is this year isn't going to like magically heal itself. Like, it does seem like I think he'd be better off with a long IL stint. I know that is going to ruin the rest of the team, but even with him, it's not like they're lighting the league on fire. Although, what was the stat that came out today? They're like second in the league in home runs per game.
Yeah, that's the only thing carrying them.
Made up fucking stat. That can't be true.
They're bottom 10 in batting average and they're bottom 10 in OBP. The only thing they're doing is hitting homers. That's
who?
It.
Us.
The Red Sox.
Home runs per game. That's the stat you want?
We're two
just
or three.
Just homers total.
Well, yeah, both. We're two or three in that.
I'll tell you right now.
So for homers right now, the Red Sox are third with 24. The only teams with more are the Dodgers at number two with 26 and the Orioles with 30 at number one. It's the only reason their offense functions. It's complete boom or bust. But I will say with Devers, right, like he got hurt playing the field. He tweaked his knee on a grounder. So that's that. And then, yeah, Devers got hurt during spring training. I don't know. The shoulder looked like it had improved enough for him to go out there and look more comfortable at the plate. He didn't look like he was in pain every time. The knee? That terrifies me, because if he's feeling it at the plate where he feels like his leg's giving out and he already can't play defense, then there's no point. Then you have something serious, and if it's going to turn into a fracture or a stress fracture or something like that, then yeah, sit him down, because you're not going to try to add that kind of injury that, who knows, he has a bad knee, he might never be able to play third base again. Like, with the current way he is, then you might be already moving down to the DH line, which, Coley, I know you're ready to jump down that at any time.
But, I mean, the team would be inarguably better this year if he was the DH.
100%.
The Red Sox are fourth in home runs per plate appearance.
Okay.
Tied with the Dodgers. It goes Orioles, Brewers, Royals, who are basically tied in a three-way tie with the Red Sox and Dodgers. They're 3.3%. We're 3.2.
I mean, this offense rakes.
Yeah, have you seen it?
These guys just hit bombs.
Dude, this lineup, dude. That's what everyone's saying about the Sox right now.
Like, I mean, you watch this team and you're like, this is not a real baseball team. And then you look at the numbers and you're like, wait a second.
the thing that annoys me is they can still win games. Like, they should have won on Tuesday. You should have won that game. And
they should be 17-3, Steve.
Mm-hmm. I know, like, they should be 14-6. That's not even like a crazy
17-3, Steve.
They should be 17-3. That's not even a crazy thing to say. And yet that's why I get back to the Devers thing. Cause it's like, Tyler, I get what you're saying, but if Rafael Devers going to the 15-day IL would actually improve him and get a better version of Devers back, I don't think it would change the outcome of games that much in the next 2 weeks.
I look at
and if he's hitting 190 in there.
I look at Pablo Reyes today, who made two errors in the same inning that arguably cost you that game today. Like, that's who you have playing third base on
Reyes
a regular basis.
I think he'd be better third over a consistent period of time than Devers, so I don't think it would be much different. If not,
I genuinely don't think he would.
But if not, worst case level, I don't think it's going to be like that crazy. Like, Devers obviously stinks over there.
But Devers stinks, and we've talked about it, on like the most routine of plays, and it's with his glove. Devers actually has like a, I won't say a plus arm, but his arm's never really the problem. Pablo Reyes cannot reach first base at all. Like, his arm is worse than anything I've ever said about Trevor Story. Like, much worse.
And at the end of the day, when it comes to Devers, like, he came back from the shoulder injury. It was competent in both games. Like, he won for four, and then the next game he reached base three times with the double that should have won you the game. Say what you will, he's still walking and getting on base as well. Like, it's a 328 OBP. So I have faith Devers could get by, but if it's at the point where he can't do anything, that was with the shoulder injury and he got the time off. The 4 days got him there. The knee injury is a whole different conversation, but this is why Cora is fighting it and trying to push through, because he knows you put him down for 2 or 3 weeks, the team's going completely underwater. And it's probably going underwater either way. That's fair. Yeah. But Cora's trying to keep the team from falling off a cliff for as long as he can here. I can't blame him for doing that. And if you're going to sit him here a couple days, all right, we'll give him a couple days. What's going to hurt? Because at the end of the day, we're not winning anything anyways.
I'm saying if we're gonna spend the rest of the fucking season going, it's not gonna, nothing matters anyway, then what the fuck does anything
but
mean?
But that decision right now is why Cora's trying to hold it, because he realizes the season's hanging on by a thread. It's hanging by the thinnest of threads.
I don't know if right now the season's hanging on by a thread.
Exactly. You could argue it's already falling off.
No, I'm not even, like, they're 10-10. Like, I don't know. It's obviously, it's been a weird year. You start 7-3, you go 3-7 since. I'm more saying, and there's no way to prove this, that if the IL stint got real Raffy Devers back, then I don't think the trade-off is something that monumental of sacrificing 2 weeks for 4 great months of Devers. Right? Like, I don't think that's crazy.
I think you got 2 bats in your lineup and you're hoping that they can somehow
carry
you.
That's implying that O'Neill comes back for the Guardian series and that Yoshida doesn't just smack the ball into the earth every at bat. Like, there's other things
he's fucking gonna. I promise.
He will.
And I like Yoshida. Like, the beginning of a baseball season always fucking sucks because it's all you have to base it off of. You can point to previous years and all this, but right now we have a 20-game sample size and the fucking lineup's dog shit. I still like and believe in Yoshida. I still like and believe in Abreu to a lesser degree, but they've been dog shit for 2 weeks and that's all we have to base it off of. So that's all we think it's ever going to be again. And we just know that's not the case.
I wouldn't be surprised if Rafaela got going. I had a tweet today that I think got like messed up a little bit. I was more trying to do a joke at like Breslow looking at Rafaela's baseball savant and being like, oh my God, this is really bad. I understand he's a rookie. Like, I get that he hasn't had that much experience. To me, and this is probably stupid, he looks hitterish. Like, I still expect him to figure this out. He's taking awful cuts, way out of the zone. I think Uke was right. He's pressing. I wouldn't be surprised if he eventually starts to get going. It's just you don't have, from 3-9 in your lineup today was a Woo Sox lineup. You just can't afford to let guys keep trying to get better like that.
I don't want to hear anyone bitch about Sadon Rafael's bat. Correct. I don't. Because I don't know and what I'm, the I'm fuck not, else man. You wanted. Seriously. Everyone wanted to sit there and go, you know, look at how special he is. Look at how special he is. We've talked about what the concerns were. Everyone knew he was going to come up and he was going to swing at everything out of the zone. So third highest chase rate in the big leagues right now. It's who he's been the entire way through the minors. Does it mean he's not going to, you know, figure it out? I think the ceiling is a league average bat. I think that's what you're hoping for here with how much he chases. But it's going to take time for him to get there. Like,
gotta
a majority of guys take time to get there.
Cody?
Well, there's a question for Tyler. He's sucked to start every level and then has gotten better, right?
Yeah, very true.
Yeah. I just want to make sure I wasn't like coping or trying to misremember something. There's so many fucking minor leaguers. I try and remember as much as I can. So yeah, him scuffling now doesn't mean he's going to be shit forever. But to the pressing point, the whole team looks like they're pressing. Everyone looks like they're pressing at all moments of every aspect of the game.
Casas told you they were pressing, basically.
Because
when they lost 4 in a row, he said it felt like 40.
You have a majority of these young guys and you're asking them to carry this team and figure it out. That, like, it's just unfair to this core, and that's why they needed support. And I think that's why you see the hesitation with Devers, because it's like you're putting even more pressure on these guys to carry you for 2 weeks when we know damn well they can't carry anything.
The thing that sucks is that the rotation's been so good that they haven't had to do much to quote unquote carry the team. Like, they could still have a better roster or a record with the Woo Sox roster they have. Like, that's probably what's most frustrating.
They just have to play defense. The fucking
the
Kansas City Royals,
you're 10-10.
The Kansas City Royals have not allowed an unearned run yet this year. The Red Sox have allowed 25.
That's 26.
So 26?
26.
Every time you look up, there's another one. Yeah,
I was going to say, I tweeted 26. Out 24 during the game, and I don't remember more happening. They said it on the broadcast, but that's me assuming OB had it correct.
That was at least Ness and post game.
You know what, dude? I don't know if that's true. I'm gonna fact check that right now.
I mean, please, it sucks either way.
We all have the wrong or different numbers, and none of them are
If it's
good.
Only 25, this team's doing great. If it, like 26, then it starts getting a little dicey.
So they have allowed.
Sorry, Jake.
It's all good.
They've allowed 81 runs, 55 of them earned. So 26, right? Right?
Right.
Yeah.
Nailed it.
26.
That's what you said.
That's what I said.
Yeah.
26.
Yeah.
Yeah. Wow. Willy Abreu, game saving catch. Who cares? They lost. Weissert's killing me. Single, stolen base, pop out, intentional walk, single, 7-6, Cleveland, fly out, ground out. That was in the 10th. Thank you, Connor Wong. Sack fly, made it 7-7. This is the first game that went to a second page. Thanks for coming out, Josh Winkowski. Walk, single, 8-7, sack bunt, intentional walk, single, 10-7. I said no chance we win this game. Didn't even make it interesting. 10-7, Guardians in 11 innings to fall to 9-9 and last place at the time.
Tyler, can we address Pablo Reyes for getting how many outs there were at the end of the game as well? Just to add another mental mistake to all of it.
Yep, he did. I thought a run scored on that. I stand corrected on that. It was, I think it was first and second, not first and third.
I think one thing in this series that stood out to me is that when Class A came in a close situation, a save situation, one run lead, nobody out, it felt like the game was over. When Kenley Jansen came in with a one run lead and nobody on, nobody out, it felt like the game was over for a completely different reason. I don't think any of us, well, Coley, you've been defending him, so maybe you thought he was going to save the game, but that was the perfect situation for him to blow it. And then for him to blow it, it's like that's a double loss for me. It's like, dude, we expected you to mess this up and you didn't surprise us in a good way. Like, just immediately, boom, blown save. This should be a split series. I know we've already said that, but that game Tuesday was such a pain in the ass. And those count for so much more. When you come back from down 5-1, sure, take a 6-5 lead, Devers huge hit. Like, all right, nice. Let's go. I gave them a 0% chance when it was 5-1. And then, you know, Kenley in that spot, it's like, come on, man. Like, we already expect so little of you, and then you blow it.
He's been flirting with that pretty much all season. To happen in that game particularly felt extra sinister because of what you're saying. Like, I do think they needed positive vibes, and he was like, fucking nope. to compare him to Class A feels disingenuous a bit. Class A may be the best reliever in baseball.
No, I know. I'm just saying the feelings as a fan you get when he came in from their bullpen, I'm like, sure, ah, shit, this thing's over.
Yeah, I don't know. Like, that's what people would have said about Kenley at the same age Class A is. You know what I mean?
Yeah,
like,
yeah.
That's where it feels a little
just saying the closers in the series, that's all.
Sure,
just
like, yeah, our no, guy comes in. I got you, for sure. Class A is disgusting. But yeah, the baseball gods couldn't have had a game where Joely Rodriguez was in line for the win and Kenley Jansen got the save. Like, that's just not, and Liam Fennessy's in the stands. Like, that's just not how that ends. Like, that is not how you draw that one up. Like, there was, he had no shot. None.
I'll BRB. You guys keep talking.
Flix is here.
Quit.
Imagine.
giant camera.
Hey, JK, we're outside. Yeah. we're at the door.
So I didn't give you my address.
How did you even figure this out? Tyler. I was just hoping. Yeah, I was hoping we would get a little. I know we've been ripping Kenley and Coley. I don't think you've been too far off, really, in defending him. Because in your defense, he had only given up what, one hit leading into this series. So, like, I get it, but it had still been such a nightmare that this was brewing the whole time, and then for it to happen was even more of a letdown. It's like, come on, man, you could have proved us wrong, and instead you just continue the narrative that this could be a really rough year for you.
No, the timing was as bad as it could get, and it would have been worse if Abreu didn't make an absurd catch. Abreu,
crazy catch.
Yeah, his defense and right is confounding. Like, he made that slide catch today, and his entire body just rejected it. He just go ahead, Tyler.
His leg failed after he slid and got that ball. But it's almost Dever-esque, where he'll make these extremely tough plays, but you give him a ball on the ground that's right at him, and he's going to kick it four times around. But he'll come up gunning. He has the arm.
He's not going to let us have a specific opinion about his fielding. He's like, no, no, no. You think I suck? I'm going to make the best catch you've seen all week.
Right.
And then I'm also going to bobble a ball that goes right to me, and a guy's going to score because of it.
Yeah, you can tell. He played infield maybe when he was like 6 years old, first grounder to him. They were like, we're going to move you further away from the ball. Like, we're just going to move you back.
I hate the Statcast data because the home run robbery, right? Everyone, I think, looked at that and was like, holy shit, what a catch. I think it had like 90% catch probability. And then the one that he made to save Kenley had 70%. So they were basically saying neither one of those catches were even anything special. That tells me alone, fuck that stat. I don't ever want
to
see
it. What happened
like
to Bullet?
That.
He died.
Stay strong.
I didn't do that.
Is Bullet at your house?
I didn't do that.
Is that who was at the door?
No one was at the door. I had to blow my nose. I was fucking leaking like all Bullet, over the place.
Brother.
Extra brutal.
Yeah, my internet's been bad today.
That's something.
Yeah.
It's been tough.
The worst just,
one
the
other
season.
Thing, one other thing with Abreu that I notice, and it's hard, like, Cole, you kind of mentioned this, where we only have these guys to go off of, these 20 games to go off of. I'm going to grade what I watch in front of me. Yes, okay. Is this an ownership problem? Of course. Of course that's the problem, but this is the team that's been put out there. Abreu, Valdez, Hamilton, you go down the list, all the guys that probably shouldn't be here, they do stuff that shouldn't happen at Fenway Park. And it's consistently. They can't go 9 innings without showing you, I'm a minor league player. One thing that was really minor, and I'm probably going to make too big a deal out of it, Abreu scored the tying run, I believe, in the bottom of the 10th inning. And credit to the Sox for only giving up one run there in the top of the 10th. I thought that was going to get out of hand, and it doesn't. This is on Tuesday. Abreu celebrated as if they won the game. And it's like, dude, you're the ghost runner, and the sac fly brought you in, and he was doing like the big yells and all that. It's like, I was going to act like, you know, say, you know, act like you've been there before, and he hasn't. And so yeah. I get part of it is that you have to get these under your belt to start to act like you've been there before. But he'll do some stuff occasionally where I'm like, dude, and Euclid was all over him correctly for running into that out to end the inning when there was no force at third base. It's like, yes, wait a little bit, make him make the throw. It's that little stuff consistently that shows up for this team.
He's been picked off too this year as well. What, at second base in the Seattle
yep.
series?
Which yeah, is you another... ain't cool unless you're getting picked off.
Yeah, it is true. It's cool to do that. That's right.
Yeah, everyone's been getting picked off.
I mean, it's just like a strikingly dumb team. And in 2018, it's unfair to, like, I can't say, tell Steve he can't compare Kenley Jansen to Emmanuel Clase and then compare this team to 2018. But it's like almost the complete opposite. Like, it's almost a direct juxtaposition of this fucking team, because that team, they were aggressive on the bases, but I don't remember I don't think it cost them a single game that year. This when they were ultra aggressive, taking extra base, forcing other teams to make throws. They weren't like the greatest defensive team that was ever assembled either, but they made every routine play. All
except for Ian Kinsler.
The Big Hit Kins was not there for his glove, and you know that.
Big Hit Kins was like, listen, this game is too entertaining to stop it now.
Yeah. We are not sweeping this thing.
Mm-mm. Yeah.
No, where's the fun in that?
Let's keep it going.
This team, I know the bases are technically bigger. Like, I get that in my head. I don't remember a team like just not being able to turn a routine double play. And I don't even mean like they fuck up the transfer between shortstop and second base. I mean, like, they just aren't getting the guy at first ever. Like, perfect throw. I'm like, is Casas not stretching far enough? Do these guys have the weakest arms in the league? Are they taking too long because they don't trust their own arms to throw it? I think it's maybe all of those things.
I think Pablo and David Hamilton legit just do not have the arms necessary to play the positions they are.
Valdez either. Like, I don't know on the double play they didn't turn today, Jose Ramirez beat it out. I believe it got them a run. He, like, double clutches because I think he's like, if I just try and throw this like every other second baseman in the league, it's going into deep right field. Like, there's no way it goes to first.
I noticed this today about David Hamilton, but there was a ground ball to him that, like, his throw to first base looks like Tyler O'Neill throwing home. he puts everything he has into that throw to just get it there.
And he puts air on it, too, because he's like, I'm going to have to sail this thing because it's coming back down soon. You mentioned the dumbness, Coley. I was going to say, is this the dumbest Red Sox team we've ever seen? We mentioned it. It is still 20 games in. At the bare minimum.
No, they're dumb.
Their dumbness per game, the DPG, is through the roof.
League leading.
League leading, but I think that's Red Sox history leading. There's no way they've ever been dumber per game than this team.
Well, because the thing, and we'll get to you in a second, Tyler.
I have the stat if Steve's looking for it.
Oh, you got the DPG?
Dumbness
per
game?
The DPG. What is it?
I listed every dumb play this series. I had 12 over 4 games, so it's 3 per game right now.
Yeah.
The 3 DPG.
That's what I was going to say. Is like when you talk about home runs, it's like, all right, yeah, we can talk about home run rate, home runs per game, home runs per plate appearance, and sort all that out. But even the best teams are going to have games where they hit no home runs.
Sure.
The Red Sox will not play a game this season where they don't do something dumb. They're going to do something dumb every single night, multiple times at least.
Do you even have Hamilton getting thrown out at first after he was already safe on this?
I did not.
Can you list it off? Can you list it, please?
Yeah, yes. So it's 13. 13. 13 is the number.
We are up to 13, and it's actually even scarier if you think about the Tanner Houck game, because I don't think I had one listed from that game, but Hamilton would be the one I guess you would count.
Yeah, you do, because, yeah, David Hamilton has a phobia of stepping on bases. That was in the seventh inning.
Which, he hit the bag. He did hit the bag.
All right, but
they,
like,
called that
even
wrong
if he,
on the broadcast.
He turned left.
Yes.
That's fine, right? But like the fact that it wasn't visible to the naked eye is a problem. Like, step on the base.
So that's why he was out, right? We agree that's why he was called out.
He turned left, 1,000%. Yeah. Yeah. Which is dumber than missing the bag. Like, so much dumber, especially when the guy you're running into has the fucking ball. No other way to turn than right there. No other
way. This team makes you yell at the TV a lot. Did he turn left? Like, he turned left.
Mm-hmm. You couldn't believe it. They tagged him, and then they just give the out sign. Yeah, they were just so focused on the foot.
Immediately out.
Most out.
Yeah.
Bozo.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, we're obviously talking about the Houck game here. I'll just breeze through these because we're going to talk about the latter end of it. First line says, quick outs for Tanner Houck got me feeling frisky. That was the first game where I was like, man, like, I feel like this game's in cruise control. I'm feeling pretty nice.
Describe it a little bit.
Like a little frisky. Like, nipples were tender. Like, it's not like that. Like, it's kind of a mix of like sensitive, but you know the feeling.
Were they hard?
No, but they're just like, they're like tender.
Mm-hmm. Aroused.
Yeah, yeah. Like, you like just like a blow on autumn would feel good, you know?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Getting a run on a balk is the first good thing to happen in ages. That was in the third inning. God bless the Connor Wong dong gong home run, 2-0 Sox in the fourth. First time a Red Sox starter has seen the seventh. David Hamilton has a phobia of stepping on the bases. That was in the seventh. If I see Kenley in the ninth, I'm going to kill myself. And then that was it. It's just the next line is Houck, CG, Shuppies, 9 innings, 3 hits, 0 earned runs, 0 walks, 9 strikeouts, 94 pitches, 1 hour and 49 minutes. That was it for that game as far as the notes go. So, like, when we're thinking about, like, dumb shit, I guess it was kind of, if you don't want to say he missed the bag, all right, fine, he touched the bag, but then he turned left.
That's worse.
Yeah. Yeah. He seems like a nice guy. I mean, he's been getting beat up on this podcast a lot, but, I mean, he's made a lot of bonehead plays.
If the Red Sox don't care or think about his confidence and how he feels inside, like, at the end of the day, what are we supposed to do? Like, the organization's willing to throw him under the bus and let him embarrass himself on a daily basis. Mm-hmm. Because they believe their metrics, and this is, like, where I think the conversation where people are trying to blame Cora for whatever it is. The Red Sox front office believes he can play defense. Like, they've told people behind the scenes their defensive metrics back it up. It's ridiculous. I don't know what metrics they have. They think because he's rangy, he can play the position. It's like, no one gives a fuck about your range if you can't make the throws. It doesn't matter how far you can go to get the ball.
It's also, no, I wouldn't even argue rangy, because the first runs Cleveland scored today was that slap through the left side where he was just nowhere near the ball at all.
Don't disagree. But this is their outlook on it. This is why they gave him minor league defensive player of the year.
No, that guy's been beaten to death with hammers, so that's been taken care of.
He is dead now, we can confirm. Mm-hmm. The guy that gave the award over is dead.
So. Mm-hmm.
We also, Jared, have no intel or proof that he is a nice guy. He could stink at that, too.
Yeah, that's true. I mean, I'm just kind of guessing. I have no idea about any of these players.
No.
Like, I don't know anything about them.
And when you like
Camp Story?
When you watch...
Story's not on the team anymore.
Another strike
against him. He's dead, too.
Yeah, when you start to talk about, like, why watch this team at all, there aren't even a lot of guys who you go, oh, yeah, he'll be here next year, let alone 3 years from now. It's like Rafael, they gave him an extension. I assume he's here. Duran, we have in some sort of indentured servitude. He's here. Like, he doesn't hit free agency until 2029, which isn't even a real year. What, Tyler?
Coley, we don't know if he's going to be here based on his comments the other day.
Started. He might be enlisted.
Oh, my God.
He might be going to war.
This team is so pressing. He's like, put me right in the thick of it.
all the people that had an issue with me saying I know how Jaren Duran's brain works because we're very similar, try and check me on that now. You go back to 2012, Red Sox finished in last place, and I was like, get me to Iraq stat. And now we got Jaren Duran after three place last place seasons saying, I would love to join the military in the middle of my prime of my big league career. So you want to say that I don't know how his brain works? Checkmate.
I want whoever is in our scouting department. Like, we have plenty to fix. That's what they said all offseason. We've fallen behind the times. We got to stop scouting these guys with military aspirations. I'm so tired of our players going overseas, flying helicopters and doing whatever it is Jaren Duran thinks he's going to do. I'm sick of it. Mm-hmm. Build the submarines. That's it. That's all we can do.
Got to build them. Oh, by the way, since we brought up Jaren Duran, I heard him talk after the game today. And for the discussions that we've had about, like, all right, Trevor Story's down, so who's the veteran? Who's the voice? Like, Jaren Duran, to me, not a veteran. No. But, like, the way that he was talking was like, I like that. He, you know, stop punching lockers and start talking how he was talking after the game today. He was like, we just got to turn the page. We're going to go out there. We're going to battle. We're going to, you know, put our best foot forward. Like, there's a lot of cliches that you would expect from, you know, an athlete. But at the end of the day, he was accountable. He sounded like he gave a shit, which is like something that was surprisingly new to me as a Red Sox fan from this group. Like, everyone else is just like, man, it is what it is. You know, how many how many weeks left until the offseason?
Shout out Verdugo.
Yeah, like that's what I'm used to as a Red Sox fan. You know, when I hear the fucking players talk, they're always Eeyore, woe is me, woe is the roster. You know, how many fucking days are left of this thing before we can go home? But like, Duran was talking like, I mean, I don't believe that this team is going anywhere, but the way that he was talking almost made me feel that way.
They can hang around. This is what, like, I don't want to be all doom and gloom because they can hang around. Like, they have enough talent.
Oh, they're going to hang around.
This roster to hang around. As it stands right now, they're a game out of a wild card spot. Is that a stupid thing to look at right now? Of course it is. Mm-hmm. But guys like Duran, and you go down the list is very short, will contribute and actually help them stay afloat. That's, you know, still, you get back to Devers and these other guys, you're going to need O'Neill to be healthy. You're going to need Yoshida to do anything. Like Coley mentioned, I do believe he will pick it up a little bit. It's hard to be much worse. So I'm glad Jaren's talking like that because I think they know we can still hang around with this team. The division's hard. Great. But the AL's not, like, stacked, you know, especially in that wild card position, the third spot.
They need Grissom to be better than his, like, he will be, you know what I mean? He needs to have his first 20 games be unbelievable, and then he can settle down after that. But if he comes up and he starts hitting, I think that'll have a lot more buy-in from guys.
I forget about him all the time. When is he coming back? I forget we have him, honestly.
He needs to finish. So Cora said today, obviously, we're Rep Snyder coming back. Grissom needs to go all the way through the 20-day rehab assignment, so we're probably looking at another 2 weeks. Like, that's right around.
Isn't that
he
long?
He played second for the first time today.
Yeah, he's been DHing.
Just need him to hit. Just need him to hit.
I mean, start of May, not terrible.
Yeah, I mean, everything we heard about the guy is that he's an average defender. That is an upgrade.
Massive upgrade.
Yeah, huge.
But you look around the roster, it's like, all right, hopefully Grissom's, please God, just have an answer at second base for at more than a year, please. Casas at first, Devers at third, Duran and Rafaela, like, it's, most of the team's already here. Like, they're locked into a lot of these guys. And then there's three guys they keep waving at you in the minors. And it makes me think, like, are they fast-tracking them? Because I don't want them to fuck with them either.
Well, do you know how excited we'd be to have an average second baseman?
Thrilled.
Like, that sounds awesome. If he's average defensively in second and he can hit, that's huge. That's absolutely huge.
Did you hear Casas this series after one of the games? I don't remember who asked him or why, but he was talking about Teal, Meyer, and Anthony, and he was kind of like, can't wait till they're up here. And it's like, I don't, like, no one else picked up on it. It didn't become a story, but it really should have been a bigger story where he was just like, can't wait to have fucking good players around me.
Sick of these bums. I don't want to play with these scrubs anymore. Come on. At least I can hit.
Yeah, and it wasn't like, that's not exactly what he said, but he did use the word fast track, for the three of them, which kind of surprised me. I didn't expect to see at least two of them this season. But if he's talking like that, are all three of them on this team in September?
I would love that so much. I don't care if they lost 20 games. I don't care about the win-loss. I just want to watch them play. I just want to watch a roster that I can get excited about, because this roster does nothing for me. I feel nothing.
I think we see what Cass is, too. That's why he went to the rookie development program. Like, he's already put his kind of hope moving forward, because he knows no matter what, he's here another 5 years. Like, it starts with them, because nobody is coming to help us from outside the organization. It's these guys, me, Brian Bayo, obviously Devers at the very top, but Casas is going to kind of be like, when those guys come up here, he'll be the guy they lean on. You know, he'll start to be that middle buffer, with Devers being, you know, the true veteran of the team.
35 years
old. We can't emphasize enough how great it is that he just speaks his mind and doesn't hold anything back. I don't think he ever says anything too out of line, but we are going to reference this entire season Tristan Casas' quotes, because they're great and they're to the point. And he's like, yeah, this is how I'm feeling. Jared, when you mentioned the feels like we've lost 40 in a row, please say that, because that's how it feels like for us. So that kind of stuff does help you get through the season. I now want to hear this quote about the top three guys in the minors. I'm sure it wasn't just like, please get them here because this team sucks.
No,
but
it wasn't. But he did use the phrase fast track, which is not something I had associated with them at all. Teal is older, so I thought there was a chance we'd see him this year, even though of all the positions, catcher hasn't been the problem for us. So that's almost like, do you even bring him up? Like, do you just trade McGuire to wherever the fuck and bring him up? But yeah, I assumed Meyer and Anthony were maybe middle of next season. Now, just watching them, Meyer's been unbelievable. Clearly, we can point to the injuries last year as the problem at AA.
Which should have always
been. Of course, same thing with Miguel Blaze.
Everyone's like, I don't know. Well, he got hurt.
He got hurt. He's been unbelievable this year. Did he push it to 9 today, Tyler? I know he had an 8-game hitting streak.
Yeah, he's up to 9.
All right, 9-game hitting streak. Roman Anthony's OPS is even higher. Kyle Teal just singles every time he steps in the box, and he's got an elite arm throwing everyone out at second. Yeah, I mean, the ownership told us to our face, like, those are the guys. They walked him around winter weekend. They had Roman Anthony, like, throwing out opening pitches last year in September. Like, they're screaming at you loud and clear. These are the three guys. So Tyler, do you think they're on a faster track?
I think it depends. I look at Kyle Teal. I think he can move pretty quickly here because of his advanced age and what he did in college and his profile overall. There's not much to develop. I think with Roman Anthony, he's in that special, I call it Rafael Devers tail, where if he continues to look like he is and he's lighting up AA, to the point where he's reached base in every single game going back to last year he's ever played at AA. Like, he's not overwhelmed at all, and he's still a friggin' teenager. He's 19. So, like, you're talking about that? Are they willing to get aggressive maybe after 50 or 60 games? I think so. But I also think with Marcelo Meyer, the K rate, there's some stuff in the zone they kind of want to work on with him. Like, the K rate's still kind of in that 25% area. He's going to need to bring that down a little bit. I wouldn't be shocked if we see two. I'd be surprised if we all saw three, but I think by the middle of next summer, they are all on the team no matter what. But I think if I was to bet, Roman Anthony continues to be, you know, one of the top prospects in the sport, top 10 guy by the end of the year. And I think Kyle Teal just advanced for his age. They realize what that can do for a team. They probably flip Reese McGuire or Connor Wong. They pick one and move one of them at the deadline. And we're talking about Teal starting up at that point.
Steve?
This is unrelated. I just don't know if we've talked enough about Tanner Houck. Can we give him a round of applause for the complete game?
Yeah, I think, you know what? I think we can. I think, was it Coley's tweet that was like, why are they treating it like he just threw a perfect game?
No, I texted it.
Down bad.
I texted it, but I was going to bring it up.
You texted it?
I had to double check the
more
box.
More so today. I didn't feel it so much last night, but then, like, when they were interviewing him during the game today, they were all a part of history. I was like, all right, yeah, like, you know, complete game shout out, no walks, under 100 pitches, like, that's fucking awesome. But they were like, man, like, what are you wearing when you get to Cooperstown, dude?
where is that ball right now? Yeah. Where are you putting that ball?
He did pocket it. He did pocket the ball at the end of the game.
They're like, what did you say when Joe Biden called you? Like, what did you guys talk about?
I mean, I can't believe he threw a complete, like, it's in the middle of April to throw a complete game and have it be an hour and 49 minutes. When OB said that, I actually laughed out loud. I'm like, that game was 149.
Yeah.
That's absolutely insane.
I was pissed.
I didn't know what to do with the rest of your night.
Yeah, I was like, now what? Like, we just had like the 11 a.m. game where I had the rest of the day to just do nothing. And then it's like, all right, like I like being able to sit down and just watch a Red Sox game. And then it was, I mean, you got to have Manfred do something about the whole length of these games. Like, they're
I feel bad. Like, every night at Fenway, I always figure someone's like night of the year. It's a birthday. It's a big celebration. It's whatever. Whoever went to Fenway on Wednesday night for their like only trip, they want to get some drinks. They want it. The alcohol sales ended at 8:43 p.m. Like, that is absolutely unheard of. So I do feel bad for those people. We got to fix it. 149, unacceptable.
Listen,
it was the shortest game since Galarraga's robbed perfect game.
Oh yeah, now I want to say something real quick, Coley, because you had a good point where like they should switch it to a perfect game.
Correct.
I almost think we talk so much about Galarraga.
No, bad point.
That. No, I'm not saying that it's like it already feels like a perfect game, but like he's still, for baseball cool thing, it's like he's still gotten like so much extra credit for not throwing a perfect game that it does almost feel like it's gotten perfect game attention. I agree, it should be a perfect game.
Yeah,
but
like if it were the if it weren't the 27th out, I wouldn't feel this way. Like it, he got the next guy out. It was so like it wasn't close at all. He's also been actively petitioning the MLB to change it for like 5 years now. And they just keep telling him what you say, Steve. They're like, we feel you've gotten more attention than an actual perfect game would have. You've actually won in this situation. If I remember at the time, there was like a deal with Chevy. If someone threw a perfect game, they got a free truck. I'm pretty sure he still got the free truck because they felt so bad for him. But it's one of those things like it's no one. Like, it's just such an easy decision to me. Like, just give him the fucking perfect game.
But if he doesn't, if he actually gets the perfect game, I think we look back. Who was that Tigers guy, by the way? Who? I think he threw one, right? Instead, we talk about him all the time.
But I still forget his first name because there was a different Galarraga who was better than him for 15 years.
Armando.
That's right.
Yeah.
But you're talking about Big Cap.
We talked about it today on Baseball is Dead, and then Dallas mentioned, like, well, what happens to the statistics of the players who hit after him? Do they don't exist? And it's like, all right, but it was like one more guy and he was out. Like, I'm sure he would want his career batting average to go up. Like, no one's like, man.
I think that's why the league would do, that's the first thing I thought of, which is like, they wouldn't want to wipe out an at bat that did happen. It should be a perfect game. They should call it, but I bet they would look at it like, well, we can't take away an at-bat. It was in the original rules in 1856.
They've taken away entire careers. Barry Bonds, Pete Rose, Roger Clemens.
Separate.
But still, like, no one handles this stuff worse than baseball. Absolutely nobody. Like, it's why when, like, I get your point. Like, I very much understand it. If it wasn't the company line from the MLB as well, I'd like it more. But the fact that that's the reason they're like, nah, go fuck yourself. Like, they can't even admit to an obvious error. You know what I mean? It's only the MLB. Only the MLB can figure this out.
Shout out to Jim Joyce. I know they talk about how he handled it. Just handled it great. I didn't know he gave like a 7-minute presser afterwards. And he's like, I booted the shit out of that call. He said that line 5 times. They kept asking him. He's like, I don't know if I've told you enough. I booted the shit out of that call. While he's crying, I'm like, stop asking him. I feel terrible for this guy. Come on.
Yeah.
Yeah. No one, I think, would feel better than Jim Joyce if they reversed.
He would be able to rest in peace. I swear he still like can't sleep because of that
call.
Sure. It was 14 years ago. Yeah.
I feel like everyone knows his name just as much as people know Armando Galarraga's
so.
Name because of that
I
call.
Think more
yeah.
so.
Yeah.
But yeah,
he's one of the umpire. That isn't he in a commercial? Like that was Jim Joyce in that commercial that ran in like during the Super Bowl, right? You know what I'm talking about?
No. I missed it.
Oh, there was
a commercial.
I missed the commercial. I fucking missed it.
I don't.
Booted the shit out of that commercial.
I booted the shit out of it.
I didn't see it, Jared. I'm sorry.
I just missed it.
I missed it.
I fucking missed it.
You said there was a commercial and I missed it.
Mm-hmm.
That was the biggest start of Houck's career. No, I'm not trying to oversell like an April start against the guards at home, Tyler.
Well, the conversation with Houck has always been the third pitch, right? Like, that's what it was. Would he ever get the splitter to the level where, you know, he could get lefties out and have a full starter arsenal? Well, what did he do? He threw the splitter more than he has in any start in his career. He threw it 34% of the time. That was his second most used pitch. So is it any shock that the first time we see him go through a lineup three different times like this and look absolutely filthy, it's when the splitter is playing to a level we've never seen it? And I thought it was really cool to hear that, you know, last year when the Red Sox kicked Pivetta out of the rotation, they went to talk to Tanner Houck about taking him out and he just refused. He was like, no, I do not want to come out of the rotation. I know you're asking me to. I believe I can do it. Just tell me what I need to do. And they said, hey, you need to develop, you know, the splitter and the cutter and continue to move it, but you need to throw strikes more too. His strike percentage is up 6% this year. So he's pounding the zone to levels we've never seen. This is a guy who walked 3.5 per 9, who has a walk per 9 below 1 right now. I think it's 0.7 and it leads all of baseball. It's ridiculous to see what Andrew Bailey is doing for this guy, because it's clear we always saw the potential. He's just putting all the pieces together for him.
And credit to all the Section 10 listeners that pointed out he was probably building some reins before the game and then was like, how do I get back to building these so fast? Complete game, buck 49, right back to it.
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, you know, he follows on Instagram, so you know he sees all the fucking submarines. He's locked in. He's I feel like he's a dedicated submarine guy.
Definitely. Yeah, gotta be. Quick shout out to BJ, by the way. First complete game shutout at Fenway by a Sox pitcher since Brian Johnson, 2017.
I wasn't going to do it.
Oh, no.
Series finale was today. Day game. First line. This may be one of the worst lineups I have ever seen. Truly one of the worst lineups I've ever seen. I think that if you went to this game today knowing what the lineup was before you got there, like, especially knowing that, A, it's a day game, so you had to call out of work. And I get all the people that are like, oh, it's, you know, I get what you're saying, like, but would you rather be at work or would you rather be at Fenway Park? I don't care what the score is. It's Fenway Park. It's the cathedral of baseball, dude. You'd rather be at Fenway or your job? I'd rather be at my job.
What do they sound like?
Like, are you fucking kidding me, dude? This is what all the fucking people on TikTok that pretend to be from Boston sound like. Are you fucking kidding me? It's crazy how many people are on TikTok. Dude. Like, the amount of people on TikTok that pretend to be from Boston that aren't from Boston. The only people that like those, like, content creators are people that are from like Arkansas, because they think that like that's what people from Boston sound like.
I can't do it.
What does a person from Arkansas sound like?
I love the damn TikTok of Boston TikTokers. Oh, they do TikTok in Boston people. What? That's what it is.
Yeah.
The Boston accent accounts are out of control. There's too many of them. And then they see the engagement's good, so they just keep birthing more of them, and it drives me nuts.
Oh, it's terrible. I can't even imagine how Coley feels as someone who is like kind of from Boston.
I'll kill you, Dad.
I can't even imagine someone that lives on the outskirts of Boston like Coley once did.
The size of the blade
that claims Boston to be like, you know, not someone like me who, I mean, like I said, you go to my parents' house right now. It's the same house I grew up in. You go on the back porch. You can see the Boston skyline from the house that I grew up in. It's basically the North End.
You can see, you know, yeah, you can't see the skyline from the North End.
Yeah, but you can from my parents' house.
Interesting.
Yeah. So, yeah. Anyways. David Hamilton is not a Major League Baseball player. E6 in the third. Jimenez RBI single. That made it 1-1. Bernardino did his job. Six batters faced, no hits. He walked a guy, struck out two. Josh Naylor, RBI single, made a 2-1 Guardians in the fourth. Nothing crazy even happened when I wrote this. It's just how I was feeling in the moment. I just wrote, I hate watching this team. The bases were loaded in the fifth. Eventually it became 4-1, but like nothing catastrophic happened. I was just watching the game being like, I fucking hate watching this team. Jaron Duran to the triangle. I don't know how that wasn't an inside the park home run and ended up being a 2-run triple to make it 5-3 in the sixth. I feel like we all kind of had that thought, like Jaron Duran, and it was like a slow roller too. It's like that ball had forever to go. I'm like, Jaron Duran, that's a inside the park home run. It wasn't
robbed in 2021 still.
Yeah,
that was like the Leo gif. We're like, oh, like we're all, I think we're all kind of pointing like this should be it. That's what it would look like. But to Coley's point, he's fat. So
it's fat and slow.
What are you going to do? Yep.
Yeah.
Obese.
I think that's our best chance of him staying on the team is the Army is just like, we don't even have something you could fit into, pal.
He's so out of shape. Yeah. Duran. It's like, it's getting pretty bad to watch. Tyler and Duran just going opposite directions. Tyler's getting shredded and Duran's out here being fat.
Mm-hmm.
Listen, Jaron, if you need some help, if you want to take notes from somebody, we can get in the gym. I can show you what it's up. Like, you know,
seriously,
lifting a little iron.
When is the next when's the next weigh-in?
I weigh myself every single day.
Well, that's dumb. Don't do that.
I like to compete.
Don't do that. That's dumb.
What's the latest? Where are we at?
I like 41. Like 40,
don't weigh yourself every day.
No.
Because that's like now you're looking at like water weight and shit like that. Like if you want to see real progress, you gotta wait at least a week. But even that is like aggressive.
I have a system to get to the lowest possible weight every morning.
Okay, what's up?
I piss two different times. Jesus, Steve. No, I don't puke. That is awful. I piss two different times, and then I try to shit at least once beforehand, and then I stretch to get everything moving. A lot. Mm.
Okay.
Usually it works decent, and it's before I shower.
Don't listen to the career skinny guy on how to lose weight. As an also fat who's had to lose weight, I understand. Like, keep weighing yourself every day. It's definitely super mentally unhealthy, but it's the only thing. You'll fall off so fast.
If you take
a week off, I know for a fact you will. And that's not a shot at you. I'm the same way.
Looking every day is like holding myself accountable because I know if I have to look in the morning and if I'm heavier or, you know, 0.5, 0.6 one way or the other, I understand that's life. But if it's like 2-3 pounds and I'm like, you fucked up, you need to be better today. And that's kind of how I go about it.
Then you pull the trigger.
Yes, I'm actually myself. Plan. I want to get on that.
What is it? Flax seeds?
Yeah.
Some shit like that? A
couple flax.
Some mix of shit. Yep.
And Tyler just starts every morning with an enema. Yes, Tyler?
I have the last lineup of the 2012 Red Sox season to compare it to today's lineup.
Okay, go ahead.
Batting leadoff, Pedro Siriaco at second base. Number two.
Love it already.
Number two. Way better. Number two, Daniel Nava in left field. Number three, Cody Ross in right field.
3-for-3.
This team's awesome.
Number this four, is a great team.
Mauro Gomez at first base.
Ah, boy.
All right.
Legend. Killed in AAA that year. Number five, Ryan LaVarnway, DH. Hey, he's still around. Six, Jared Saltalamacchia at catcher. No?
So far, the exact same as today with two catchers.
Yep. Number seven, Danny Valencia at third base.
Ooh.
Pretty boy Danny Valencia, they call him.
Uh-huh.
Number eight, Chaishwan Lin in center field.
He was okay for a little bit.
And then number nine, Jose Iglesias at shortstop. And this is pre-2013 Iglesias when he actually started hitting.
Yeah, that's a good team.
Is
I
that
just got
better?
A notification that... from my watch that said, today has been a stressful day for you.
I can see that.
You're dying right now.
That team could...
I mean, it kind of has been a stressful day.
Could for sure field the ball.
Oh, yeah. They're playing defense. Cody Ross in right field. Are you freaking kidding me? He had a cannon out there. He was doing janitor throws before Tyler O'Neill.
They had some thump in that lineup.
Mm-hmm.
Tyler, what game was this?
The last game of the 12 season. Oh.
What am I looking at here? Yeah, October 1st, 2012.
I think they played October 3rd, 2012.
Oh, okay. Maybe.
I mean, he had early. Some. Are you fucking me, dude?
I mean.
Sorry.
I care too much about the facts. I don't like seeing Tyler get suspended as much.
Me neither. I mean, how long have we been recording for, Jake?
That was an hour 20.
An hour and 20 minutes, no suspensions.
That's impressive.
Yeah. You know what, Steve? You get a gold star for fact checking there, because I didn't even, I trusted Tyler so much. You know, if I'm a listener, I trust Tyler.
I just wanted to get James Loney some love because he played in this game.
Yeah. And that was probably better than, what's his name? Fucking Mauro Gomez.
Fucking talk about Mauro Gomez like that, okay? Do you know what he did in AAA that year?
I need it in the big leagues. I need it in the big leagues.
Need it in the bigs.
Because this last game, we had Ellsbury, Pedroia, Nava.
This isn't fitting my narrative. This isn't fitting my narrative. Please stop.
Well, if you had said, like, third to last game, you were the one who just lied to us for no reason.
I wouldn't call it lying. I was just, you know, lining it up nicely. Let's hear Mauro Gomez. 100 games in AAA in 2012, 310, 371, 589, 960 OPS with 24 jacks. That's cool. What the people want.
Need in the bigs.
Need it.
He never went back after that 2012 stint. He died with that team.
It's like, you know, check out what Adam Hyzdu did in the fucking AAA team for 2004 Paw Sox. We don't win it in 04 without Adam Hyzdu's AAA numbers.
Big Dew.
The Dew. What did he hit?
But how you doing?
Adam Hyzdu.
How do you do?
Adam Hyzdu. In 2000, I mean, he was probably a beast. Oh my God, dude. 2004 for the Paw Sox. 129 games. He hit 301 with a 980 OPS. 29 bombs. 33 doubles. And he drove in 79 runs. Where were you when Adam Hyzdu was the fucking best hitter on the Paw Sox in 2004? Where were you, Tyler?
6 years old. I didn't know anything that was going on.
Yeah, well, got on base at a 413 clip.
Not Mauro Gomez.
You think the Yankees finish the job if Adam Hyzdu's not doing that in Pawtucket?
Lurking in the shadows?
Yep. Played 17 games that year, got called up by the Sox, played 17 games, hit 300 with an 1164 OPS.
People want to talk about that, but no one's talking about Mauro Gomez. 100 OPS plus in those 37 games.
I don't give
league
fuck
average
about
hitter.
Mauro Gomez.
What's your problem with Mauro Gomez?
We're talking about Adam Hyzdu.
Yeah, this is the Hyzdu hour, and you know that.
Yeah. Jake, book Adam Hyzdu.
What was his OPS plus in the big leagues?
The first guest for the return of Section 10 is Adam Hyzdu.
You see Jake on the phone. He's like, I need Hyzdu.
I need Hyzdu.
Jake, right, fine, we'll pay it.
Jake, yeah. Book Mauro Gomez.
Yeah. Adam Hyzdu is like, I have an appearance fee. And we're like, how high?
No number is too much. We will shovel.
Double it. Yeah, whatever your rate is, double it, dude. Adam Hyzdu played 17 seasons in the minors.
No, he didn't.
Yes, he did. Oh, he played. He played over 1,700 games in the minors. That's crazy. He played in Japan, it looks like. Oh, they must have been terrified over there.
Look at the last team he played for, the Fukuoka SoftBank Hawks.
Yeah.
That was the last team he played for. Yeah. In 07, of course.
Yeah, Fukuoka.
They would go Fukuoka.
Yeah. They did that.
Yeah. They played at the Fukuoka PayPay Dome.
We got to track down Hyzdu. He's 52. You know he's not doing anything right now.
No, it says he's
married, kids.
So he's active in his local church.
Mm-hmm.
Oh, he's a Christ guy.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
At the RMCC, Red Mountain Community Church, of course.
Mm-hmm.
He got an MLB.
He was drafted in the first round.
Week.
He was drafted in the first round, 15th overall.
I love that it says. With the Red Sox in 2004, Hyzdu batted 300 in parentheses, 3 for 10.
It's 300.
Counts. Just facts.
That is like, 300.
He hit 300 with the 04 Sox world champion team.
This 1990 first round is loaded. Chipper Jones 1-1. Tony Clark, Michael Lieberthal, Dan Wilson, Carl Everett goes 10. Todd Van Poppel, 14. Hyzdu, 15. Jeremy Burnett, 17. Mike Mussina, 20. Rondell White, 24. I mean, you talk about a loaded class headlined by Hyzdu and the fellas.
Mm-hmm. He broke Griffey's home run record in high school?
Mm-hmm.
What?
You remember that?
Oh, right, I do. Now I do.
You don't remember that ad campaign? It was Mountain Dew got with him. Everyone was doing the Dew.
Mm-hmm.
Right.
Yeah.
Do the Dew for highs, do. Yeah, they had a whole jingle. Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah.
Do the Dew for highs, do.
Motherfucking highs, do.
Yeah.
They were swearing on TV back then.
They let it go. It was weird. I actually remember that. They weren't bleeping.
Yeah, they weren't. They didn't bleep back in the early 90s.
Yeah.
It was right after he got drafted. It was just like, you know, he was just, the commercial is just him socking homers to the cage. And then he cracks an ice cold Mountain Dew. And he's like, motherfucking do the Dew Hyzdu. Yeah.
He would chug it, right? And then, like, smash it on his head.
Yeah. He'd just fucking eat it.
Like a yard goat.
Right, he ate the can after. That guy was nuts.
No, he ate the can while it was full. He was like a fruit gusher.
He ate the Mountain Dews.
Yeah, he just ate Mountain Dews full.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, he was like, oh, do the Dew.
Nice Dew.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. That was back when they would just let anything go on TV.
Yeah,
the next year they started censoring in 93, but this was 92.
This was 92.
Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Yep. You think Adam Hyzdu is a Baja Blast guy?
Fuck no.
He's a classic. No. He sticks with the classic.
Like, he gets the like one with the real sugar cane still in it.
Right.
And that Arkansas hick on the bottle.
How far back do you think Mountain Dew goes?
1800s.
No, it's
got to be 1940 or
it's
something.
It's either the late 50s or early 60s.
Just a guess.
I think Steve's got to go for that. Tyler?
I'm fine with it.
I have the answer.
Get him out.
That's for Tyler. That's for Tyler.
That was crazy.
Yeah.
Crazy.
That's a Tyler. I mean,
just not active listening at all.
Not at all.
No, he's going to try and explain himself. No.
Yeah. He can come back and explain himself, but it's only going to piss me off even more. You know? What do you got, Tyler?
I come here with complete honesty and faith. Did anyone else have Jared cut out during that little
Steve said it.
Yeah, Steve said it. So
I said it,
Yeah.
I'll take the suspension. Is it coming?
No.
The suspension?
Nope.
No.
Okay.
Heavens no.
Oh, did Tyler like steal the suspension kind of? Right,
yeah.
Okay.
Yeah.
Thanks, Doug.
You were teetering. I'm sorry. And he just like burst in. Like the Kool-Aid man.
He human shielded it for you.
Yeah.
That's the kind of guy I am.
Appreciate it, Tyler. Mm-hmm.
Anything for you.
Thanks.
Yeah. Nobody gets boned by the umps more than Tristan Casas.
Brutal.
It's out of control.
Why do the olds think it's okay to like just cry and say he needs to swing at those pitches all the fucking time? That's all I get on Twitter these days. If you post it and you say he knows the zone better than umps, they're like, oh, he needs to learn to protect. He can't expect to spit on pitches 3 inches off the plate constantly. What do you want the guy to do?
I mean, the zone is the zone.
Walking.
Yeah,
idiotic.
The zone.
It's getting mean at this point because all the umps are doing it. At first, it was like, oh, okay, maybe it's one or two umps. Like, he's getting screwed by all of them.
Mm.
This guy knows the zone so well.
He's just a big dude, you know?
One of his biggest strengths is hurting him. It's crazy.
Yeah. Last line here. We suck. 3-7 homestand. The team has no life.
I said it. I don't remember if we were on stream or even on camera, but I know I said it to you. I think they're going to be much better on the road than at home this year. I think home is just depressing for them.
Yeah. I mean, they clearly play awful baseball at home. Mm. I don't know what it is about Fenway Park that makes them want to not play good baseball, but yeah, I mean, they basically just took a 7-3 start to the season and shoved it up their keisters.
Worst part is Cora, one of his major things all spring training was they needed to play better at home, but they haven't been good at home since what, 2021? That was the last time they were actually monsters there. So, you know, for what Cora said, they've already gone in the tank on that front.
Mm-hmm.
Cora also referenced, I believe, in the same quote, like wanting the atmosphere to be more lively at Fenway, even though he then tail-ended it with like, understandable, we haven't been good. And it's like, well, that you kind of answered your own question. Like, if the team stinks, we're not going to all show up and be like, let's get tonight. Like, that's not really how it goes. It also had me thinking, like, at this time of the year, genuine question, what park's buzzing? Like, what park are you like, oh, watch out, they're going into so-and-so. I can't think of any off the top of the dome.
Probably Dodgers specific to this year.
But Dodger Stadium's always so chill. I'm just saying, like, because he was talking atmosphere, right, Tyler? Sure. You're talking about that quote?
Yeah, he was just saying, you know, we haven't had that kind of competitive feel like 2021. That's what he always goes back to when they felt like everything was going. You're not going to get the playoff game, but the truth is it's a lot of visitors. It's a lot of tourists. It's people who aren't really the diehards because a lot of the diehards are starting to take a step back.
The way we look at 2021 is just—it's sad. It's not accurate, but it's also not accurate. It's like,
what do you mean?
It was just in terms of how much of a roller coaster it was. Like, I think we remember the most recent version of 2021, which was October and the end of September. But I don't remember at the park it being like rocking. It was more like, hey, maybe they make the playoffs. Hopefully they do, but almost ended terribly.
Yeah, no one gave a fuck about that team until things started going poorly for them. Then they became the easy thing to kick on radio, and everyone was like, oh, look, they're going to completely fall apart. And then when they went on a run, everyone was pissed.
Sox.
I mean, I had a fun time that year.
Yeah. Oh,
that
was amazing. Fun. Big time.
I mean, that was when 98.5, the sports hub, was telling people don't even watch the playoff games. And Lou,
I do recall that.
Lou Maloney,
I was fighting for my life.
Lou Maloney promptly was like, why don't they shut the fuck up? Which was an accurate take. I believe we said the same on our program too. I don't know why I'm giving Lou all the credit, but there he goes. Yeah, that team was at least competitive, and I remember getting on home crowds up to that point, but that last like 2 weeks of the season and the single elimination game against the Yankees, I mean, the crowd was as dominant as they were in 2018 when they had the Dodgers bullpen coach crying on national TV. So it's like, yeah, I've spoken to a lot of people in the real world who are like, I can't give a fuck about this team anymore. They literally did the Babe Ruth trade again. You want the atmosphere to change. Stop being so fucking stupid. Like this, you build a house from the foundation. The foundation of professional sports is at the top. It's the ownership. We have a dumb team because we have dumb owners. It's that simple.
Facts. And it's like you look around now and you get it almost every single night. People are taking pictures of Fenway in the open seats, and that's what it is. And like, we see it. It's depressing to us. You don't think it's depressing for the players who are out there who can look around and see? And you don't have many guys. Rafi is really the only one who can look around and be like, I remember what it was like when this place was buzzing. But that's where you build losing culture, because there's guys like Tristan Casas and Brian Bello who have never felt that. They have no idea what that's going to be like. And those are the guys who are going to be mentoring Meyer, Teal, Anthony, these other guys coming up. And that's what's scary to me when you don't give a young core like this, you know, a Justin Turner or something like that you can lean on, because nobody knows what that real shit is about and what you're trying to play for. And Cora walks, he's really the only other piece besides Devers who can connect to that.
Literally, yep. The only.
That's it. Then at that point, it's just people who have never actually experienced top of the line baseball in Boston.
Yep. I guess Duran was here for 21.
They sent him packing. They didn't even want to deal with him that year.
He was in the dugout for the playoffs, though.
He was. Mm-hmm. Yep. Houck? Was Houck on that team?
Mm-hmm. Yep.
Yeah, he started in the COVID year, right? Didn't he make a couple starts in the COVID year?
Last three.
Whitlock. Like that. Whitlock was there.
Yeah, Houck was filthy. He had like three starts with like a one ERA in the COVID year. Now he's like, let me just run that back. That's what he's doing this year. He's like, let me do my COVID shit again. Good for him.
Yeah. Well,
I wish they split, dude. I'd love to be just shoving a banana split down my throat hole right now.
Yeah. If I was just gagging on a banana with some ice cream, man, you want to talk about a Thursday night?
Mm.
Benny's. It's gonna be a long year. It's gonna be a long year. I think, you know, it feels like we're down right now because we don't want to accept it. But I think once we accept it as a unit, then we'll be able to get back to like having fun. But I think what is so disheartening about this and why it's so such a drag is because this moment came so quick.
I'm not as negative. I still think they can hang around. Like, I'm not like, oh,
I don't want to hang around.
20 minutes in.
They're going to be 500. Like,
hanging around is the worst thing they can do.
They're going to be 500 all year. That's part of the problem in my eyes. Like, they're going, I said it in the preview, like, they're going to be as mediocre as possible, which then you go back and go, oh, what could have put them over the top? A competent offseason, which they refuse to have. So it's like, you can only, every time, the further we get to the future with this season specifically, the more you're going to look back and go, yeah, one, two moves, this is a completely different team. If Matt Chapman is playing defensively, the Story injury doesn't matter as much. Obviously, it matters, but it doesn't matter as much. He could play fucking shortstop if he wanted to. That's how good he is as a glove. And they just punted on everything. Everything.
Being like, we're all 162 guys, though. I'm more just alluding to the fact of like wanting to have a quasi enjoyable summer. I'm not talking about like, oh, you know, big picture. Like, what does this mean? Like, I think they can hang around and give us moments where it seems like we're doing like a season ending pod right now. We're 20 games in, but
mid April.
I know.
But it's that
I'm not that down.
It's just it feels like you're one more thing going wrong away from it going through the floor. That's just what it feels like right now. And so
yeah, every day has been something new. That part sucks.
It's been a week. It's been, you know, the last week you've had a legit injury scare or someone's gone on the IL every single day. And it's like, I think you guys all agree. If Devers has to miss time, it becomes, you know, worst case scenario. If it's anyone else that someone goes down with a significant injury or anything like that, especially lineup wise, you lose Casas, something pops with him, you know, something happens with one of the arms in the rotation, like, the line is so thin for them, and we just know it's April 18th. Shit's going to go wrong that we haven't even seen coming yet.
And I mean, already, hasn't that already happened? Aren't we there?
Yes, it's only April 18th.
Does feel like we're due for some surprising goods, right? Instead of surprising bads.
Know? Well,
give
we got
some
that
surprising
last night.
Goods. Goalie?
They don't got them.
they don't got them.
And I like disagree with the Devers point because you can't be looking at it this season. Like, it's how many years do you have left? 11? 10?
Yeah, forever.
So that's those 10
nine more.
Far outweigh, knowing full and well the last two are going to be dog shit. The next 8 far outweigh this season.
It just depends at that point. Are we talking, is it pain tolerance and you're just pushing through that? Or are you going to do structural damage to your knee where you no longer can play? That's
obviously
then you're done.
Yeah, they can't put him in a position to mess up future years.
No,
then that's the most irresponsible thing ever.
The way Cora framed it today, it's just a bruise. Like, that's why he was kind of like, yeah, we're not considering the IL. But Devers seemingly sees it differently and is like, I need to take my time. If it's that kind of situation, yeah, sit him down. There's no point. We're not risking the guy's future. But if it's pain tolerance, go out and fucking play. Like, that's why they're playing this annoying-ass game. They've been down multiple players every single night. Like, Tyler O'Neill and Rafael Devers and going back and forth, and then Romy Gonzalez at one point. Like, they haven't even had a full bench to work with.
Whatever the hell Aaron Boone was talking about with the mid-spring banged up, that's been Rafael Devers. He's been so banged up for being a couple weeks into the season. It just, from a fan perspective, it sucks. Like, you would just wish that he'd at least be going off and then, oh, wow, he's carrying the team because he's good enough to carry a team that has the best starters ERA in baseball. Then you're 17-3.
Where would you say the Red Sox are at in runs per game in the league?
Probably like,
I think it's like 16th or 17th.
18th?
Yeah. 17th.
Middle of the
17th?
Pack.
Right?
Okay.
They're 17th, yeah. Feels not worse.
Great. Much.
Well, they snuck in a couple, like, 7-8 run games, right?
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. I think they scored, like, 2 runs a game this series.
Hmm. Well.
They need runs support.
Man, vibes are, they're down.
Mm.
They're down right now. But we got Cam Boozer coming up. Oh, yeah. Cam Boozer. He's 31, lefty. He can touch 98. I've seen him hit 98. He got suspended for pot.
Fuck yeah.
Oh, he just loves smoking pot.
Oh, he's been smoking that shit.
Any chance he gets, he's just smoking that weeds.
Yeah. Mm. What was that, like 2015? That was a while ago that they suspended players for marijuana.
Mm.
So even he cooler. Got suspended for that. Got into a car accident.
Fuck yeah, he did.
Smoking pot when he did it.
Yep. Got into a car accident and then basically retired. And then a couple of years later was like, hey, I can still throw 98. Why am I not playing professional baseball? And he came back and here he is getting called up to the big leagues this weekend in Pittsburgh.
The savior. Would have made it up sooner if he hadn't thrown 3 innings the day they needed to call someone up, which was Joe Jakes, who should never be on a major league mound ever again. Another punt move.
Yeah. Well, that's what it is.
You know whose name I thought of yesterday watching David Hamilton attempt baseball?
Ooh. Can I guess?
Yeah, I would be shocking if you got it. He was on the team last year.
Oh.
Like, that's how much I'll narrow it down, and I'm still not sure you'll get it.
Play shortstop?
Yeah.
Oh. I know.
I do think Tyler knows.
Kike Hernandez?
Why would that be the answer? Tyler.
Because they're awful at baseball.
Tyler, say it.
Bob stop?
Oh my God, no, dude. Adalberto Mondesi. Like, why not?
Well, he never even actually
he
played.
He was not on the team.
He was never
last
on
year,
the Coley. Team last year.
He didn't play.
He was
play.
Straight not on the team last year.
He was on the
40 Coley?
All season.
Coley.
He was in the dugout.
Coley.
Adalberto Mondesi.
Coley.
Big member
Coley.
Of the 2023
Coley.
Boston Red Sox.
He was not on the team last
did
year.
Did he not receive a contract to play for the Red Sox last year?
Was
he or was he not on the 40-man roster for the entire season last year?
He was great at not being on the team. That was his best.
But you said he played for the Red Sox.
I did not. I said he was on the team.
He did say on the team. He did say on the team.
Was he technically on the 40-man since he was on the 60-day?
No, he wasn't.
He absolutely took up a 40-man spot. Because you have to put him on the 40 to transfer him to the 60-day.
Yeah, initially. Yeah.
No, he wasn't on the team.
Jesus Christ.
Wasn't on the team. He wasn't on the team.
He was on the team.
He didn't play for the team. He was.
He's on the team.
He was on the. He was part
if
of the
Red Sox won the World Series last year, he doesn't get
he
a ring.
He sure does.
I think he does.
If anything, he plays in the World Series. That's the only time he's healthy.
He would have been the hero of the World Series.
I'm looking at the free agent shortstops right now. He's at the top of the list on Spot Rack. I'm saying we give him a look. He's got to be healthy by now.
He's
got to be healthy by now.
So much time off. The amount of time off.
Simply must be healthy by now. And if he's not, he's still better than David Hamilton. I'm positive.
I'm convinced they amputated.
They may have.
No other way.
They may have.
What's the last guy? The last game this guy played in?
Oh, the late 90s.
Yeah.
April 26th, 2022.
Yeah, now I need him. I need him.
This is where
it's him or like Cole Tucker. I quite frankly,
Cole Tucker just signed somewhere.
Yeah, he did.
Then
damn it.
Then it's just Mondesi.
I'll take Elvis Andrews.
I'm not even seeing him on this list unless they're listing him at a different position. Is he a second baseman on here?
Yeah, he did play a decent amount of second last year, I believe.
Where did Cole Tucker sign? Like the Nats or something?
Yeah, it was a national team.
723 days.
Angels, actually,
since his last game.
Yeah.
This guy's ready.
He has to be, you know.
It's like him, or we get JBJ out of the independent league and just make Rafael the shortstop every day.
Heard worst ideas. That's a vibes move.
Cancel the season.
Like, say what you will about Andrews, dude. Like, I'll take an 81 OPS plus and above average defense right now. That's better than what you have. And he'd be a leader.
Would he?
Yeah, he's a veteran. He's been around a
just
long time.
He's a veteran. How many people... I don't think he's here. Like, let me lead these lost Red Sox to the promised land.
Who's stepping up? He played in 2009.
I've already given up on, like, caring about who the leader is. We've all talked about it. I just want a competent team.
Like, yeah, like, where's that guy leading us to?
DPG down. That's the goal.
Just be competent. You can't be competent without a leader.
Listen, former farmhand Hudson Potts is out there, Tyler, if you want to bring Big Potts back.
I hate to say it. He's not even an outfielder anymore. He's a pitcher, right?
They got him listed at third base, so no one knows.
Oh. I think they tried to convert him at the end here.
Don't hate it.
It wasn't happening. Bobby Dalbec should do the same thing.
Bobby Dalbec.
All right.
That's
Bobby
not mean.
Dalbec should be the shortstop of this team.
I think I feel most comfortable with him in the field of anyone that's playing for the team. Like, do you not? No. When it's hit to Bob, I'm like, he's making the play.
Making the play. Yeah.
Just love dudes that make the play, man. Oh my God.
I love a good play.
If you make the play, I love you.
Yeah.
You just got to make the
play. We don't do it a lot.
No, just make the play. Just make the play.
The Red Sox would be, again, 16-6 if they make the play.
17-3, yeah. Right? 17-3.
17-3.
If they just made the play.
If they just made the plays.
Got to make the play.
Oh. The number of times they haven't made the play.
So many times.
And it ultimately cost them the game every time.
Make the play.
Yeah.
I mean, it's different. Like, and I said this to Maz. If it were offense is going to slump. Like, your pitchers, they're going to have lulls. But when you're just making errors all the time and you don't know how many outs there are and you're getting picked off and you're trying to steal third base with no outs, like, there's no cure for being dumb.
None.
We're just dumb. We're a dumb team. That's why I don't have any hope. If they were making the plays, good pitching, but they were last in the league in runs per game, it's like, all right, well, this lineup's going to hit. Like, wait until it, like, warms up a little bit. Like, this, they're going to score some runs. Like, I'm not worried about the offense. Like, they may suck right now, but I'm not worried about it. When you just, like, can't play defense, that's not something that you just, like, flip a switch and automatically just, like, remember how to do. No. It. Like, you can do it or you can't. Like, either you're dumb or you're not.
It impacts everyone. You just see it slowly fade over to the other guys. David Hamilton being nervous, nervous, nervous. And then before you know it, everybody looks nervous and they're trying to do too much. Tristan Casas. They're all pressing because they know they don't have enough.
They need something like unbelievably funny to happen in the locker room to cut the tension, or like a fight. Like, it needs to either be like so much violence, or like Emmanuel Valdez, like, trips over a chair and after falling rips like the loudest fart anyone's ever heard. Though one of those two theories, there needs to be like someone goes on the IL because Tristan Casas beat the shit out of him, or Emmanuel Valdez falls down in a comical nature, which I'm positive he's capable of, and everyone's just like, ah, these guys are all right. Let's go play ball, fellas. If
dude, remember that Valdez fight? That changed the whole season. That flipped everything around in 24.
Yeah.
Something, because they hate just showing up.
Trip on a chair and just rip a big one. Mm-hmm. That's tough.
I mean, you guys remember the fart I ripped at, what was Steve's favorite bar, Purple Monkey? Like, the one in the bathroom after the game.
Oh, my God. That was...
Purple Monkey?
Yeah.
Isn't that one of the legends of the Hidden Temple, like,
yes.
Mascots? Okay.
What is it, the purple barracudas?
No, it's purple parrots, the blue barracudas.
Silver snakes.
Orange
Coley
monkeys.
Is easily the top person we got that would know all of them. No doubt. That's right in your wheelhouse.
Yeah, I'm blanking on red. I think orange was monkeys. Jeez.
Yeah, the red jaguars,
red jags,
blue barracudas,
red
the green jags. Monkeys, yeah. Orange iguanas.
Ah,
green monkeys. Okay.
Purple
the
parrots,
green
silver
monkeys.
Snakes.
And then the shrine.
I love the music.
The shrine of the
How hard is it to
monkey?
Pull up music, Jerry? Can you pull up something like the Legends of Hidden Temple music? I think that would get us going right now.
Yeah.
Anyone else got the host name? I got the host name locked and loaded.
No. That's Mark Sanders.
No. You're thinking of A, Mark Summers, and B, yeah. This was Kirk.
Remember Summers?
Kirk Fogg.
What was the name? Summer Sanders?
That Summer
was
Sanders.
Summer right? Sanders, yeah. She was great.
She was great.
Is this even it?
Is yes. this it? This can't be it. This is it.
He swings in on a rope.
Oh, okay, yeah. Yeah,
oh, I remember right. intro. Part. But then isn't there a different one where they're like making a big decision or something, or it's like down to the wire?
Yeah, I think you're also thinking potentially Deal or No Deal.
I wouldn't mix these two up. When he's making a big decision on like $500,000 or something.
No, I mean, they have different music for when they're running through the obstacle, Olmec's temple.
Yeah, the obstacle noise. Yeah, and then you need to go through the dungeon. Yeah,
that, and then they have the final, when it's the last two teams, they have to go down those like pyramid steps to get to that. There was definitely tense music playing for that.
Yeah, Jerry, if you can find that, the tense like...
It's just a soundtrack to Legend of the Hidden Temple.
Yeah. Oh, this is it. Yep.
This is it.
Yeah.
Yeah. Sounds like Mario Kart.
That's stressing me out. Then there's just watch is gonna be like, dude, I just told you you had a stressful day, and what are you doing now? It's making it even more stressful.
I can just picture some 11-year-old with a trip to Orlando that they're already in, another trip to Orlando, and a pair of hush puppies on the line, just fucking up some puzzle, some three-pronged monkey that they don't know which is the ass and which is the head. They're fucking it up, and then a grown adult rips them through the wall if they don't have another fucking coin.
Anytime they had the adults pop in and just like shake the kids, it would scare the hell out of them. Like, you'd never want that to happen.
Yeah.
What was the dude's name that would just pop out wearing the fucking leaves?
The temple guards.
He was.
Yeah.
The what?
Temple guards.
Your guide, Kirk Fogg.
Kirk Fogg.
And then what was the name of the talking thing? Didn't that thing?
Olmec.
Oh, right.
Yeah. Looks somewhat like David Ortiz.
Hey there.
There you go.
And let's play together in the bright sunny weather. Let's
you guys, Jake and Tyler don't know this. No chance. You don't know this one?
They never would.
I was a Disney X team.
Binya.
Just take your foot in your hand.
Oh, hell yeah, dude.
All-time soundtrack. Every episode, jazzy as fuck.
What song is this, Steve?
What's up?
What song is that?
I was looking up Legends of the Hidden Temple stuff.
Oh,
what
could
fucking
hear that.
Song was that? He's trying to buy time. What
I
song is
I don't. It? I don't remember that song.
They said it.
They just said it.
Idiot.
You know that. That was Angry Beavers.
Sure was.
Angry Beavers, of course.
Yeah. You know that one, dude.
You guys watched it?
Shut up, Tyler.
Oh, classic. Rugrats. Tyler's got this one. There you go. You
gotta know that one.
It's my era.
Sure wasn't.
No way that was your era.
No?
It was one of their
I
three.
Like it was always on.
It was one of Nickelodeon's three original
programs. He doesn't remember 2004, but he remembers like 1991 episodes of fucking...
They did run them forever, Rugrats. To be fair, but it
they
wasn't
did.
Your era. That's
the first time I cried was the Chucky movie.
Banger. Big heat.
You know this one, Steve?
No chance.
Nickelodeon show?
Come on, no, Steve. You already have it.
Come on, Steve.
I'm cold right now.
You are.
Gotta give me like cat dog or something.
That was Our Real Monsters.
My life is Ginger.
Was that As told by Ginger.
Oh, yep. So yeah. I was close.
Steve? I think Steve didn't grow up with us. There's no way. Tyler?
Hey, Arnold? No, 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 no. No. One thing I wouldn't miss is Hey Arnold. That's like all I watched was Hey Arnold.
Move it, football head.
You didn't know that one, Steve?
I only watched a couple of Nickelodeon shows.
Oh, come on. Were you a Disney guy?
No.
Watching the Sox.
That was Ren and Stimpy. You never watched Ren and Stimpy?
Not really. No, I did Rugrats, Hey Arnold.
If he wasn't watching...
Cat Dog.
No, if you weren't watching Our Real Monsters.
Rocket Power. A lot of Rocket Power.
Ooh. Shout Factory TV. Changing the show.
Amanda Show?
They say it pretty immediately, guys.
I have a pair of these socks. Rocket's Modern Life. You know this one, Steve?
Rocket's Modern Life.
Yeah. Rocket's Modern
Life. Yeah. It was the little dog guy, right?
Wallaby.
He's a fucking wallaby. Oh, he is a wallaby.
He had a dog.
Oh, okay. Maybe that's what I'm thinking of.
Yeah.
Was Invader Zim?
That was after. Like, I watched it for a little, but it wasn't for me.
Oh, yeah. This is... Do you know this, Tyler? It's... I don't know it off the top, but it sounds like one word. This is one of the best ones they ever had.
Yeah. What a play, solo.
Play some killer tofu.
Dog?
There you go.
Yeah.
He got it.
Go! That's a good one.
Tyler?
Yeah.
Did you guys watch Chalk Zone?
No.
What?
The is that too late? That? Jake, you know Chalk Zone?
Nah, I can't help you there.
Yeah, what the hell's that?
It was like this kid and he would draw himself into this like chalk world. It was a little trippy.
No.
You got the Zoe 101 theme song on there?
No, but this one is the best one of them all.
Tyler, I didn't think you were getting dug. That was pretty good. Thank you.
There it goes. It doesn't get any better than this one.
Is this San Andreas?
Don't even. Just let me have this. I've had a stressful day. I hate this team.
Yeah. Keenan and Kyle, baby.
Keenan and Kyle. Kyle loves orange soda.
Keenan and Kyle, baby.
I froze with music. That makes it tough. Oh, no.
No, I didn't.
Fresh out the box. Stop. Look and watch. Ready yet? Get set. It's all that.
That's like, you gotta have that like... Like, Steve would have a great slow-mo.
Slow-mo jump. So sick.
Steve would have a great slow-mo for the All That intro. Yeah, you look like you'd be on All That, Steve. Yeah.
I love All That.
I mean, Prime SNL wasn't putting up the type of performances All That was doing. All That would have banger after banger skit, and then like the biggest artist in the world would come on and perform. Like, it was kind of insane.
Yeah. Yeah.
Give me the Guts theme one time. You want to talk? Yeah.
Oh, you talk about you have it. Oh. Guts.
You want to talk about getting ready to run through a wall?
Do you have it? Guts.
The legend Mike O'Malley tossing it over to Mike.
Baller of the show.
Yeah, he is. What I saw him when I threw out the first pitch.
The body working to the level of precision that's needed to be risen.
This can't be it.
It's the beat for sure.
I think that's like an older version of it.
Yeah, you want like the Global Guts version?
Yes, it. Do you have it? Yeah. Do you have it? Guts. Do you have it? Guts. Yeah. You know this one, Tyler?
This isn't all grown up.
You know this one, Steve?
It's not ringing a bell.
Oh, come on. You're not a Nickelodeon kid.
I've already named Nickelodeon stuff as we've gone along here.
Yeah, but
I've
like
known like you, half the stuff.
No, you haven't. You've known like maybe 15%, which is not high
at least 40.
No.
Yeah.
Sorry. No, I said.
I said no.
We just crunched the numbers and it's coming back now.
I like how he's like, let the record show I did not say yes. I said no.
But yeah. I mean the ultimate theme. People are going to have nightmares. And just by me saying that, you already know where I'm going.
Big time rush.
No, this isn't.
I was going to say.
That's the end. That's the outro.
It is.
Oh.
This one doesn't play as much over audio.
You have to see it, too.
You have to see the match strike.
But if you lived it as a kid... If you lived it as a kid,
oh, for sure.
You're seeing it as your
Are you afraid of the dark?
Yeah, that the intro was sometimes scarier than the show.
Big time.
Yeah, like
the goose.
If you've never seen it,
the Goosebumps like, intro fucked with me too. I know that wasn't Nickelodeon, but that was a fucked up intro as well.
The intro would happen. I'd actually change.
Yeah, I'd leave the house.
Yeah. Oh. Oof.
Yeah. Goosebumps was cool though.
Yeah, but like the imagery was like very trippy. There was like a dog that got killed. I'm sure Tyler loved that. Like it was very, very troublesome.
Yeah. I mean, like, Are You Afraid of the Dark was legit scary. Sure. It was meant to leave you. Like, you know how, like, in a lot of horror movies, the end is sometimes good. It's like, you're scared throughout, but then the end is like, oh, thank God, like, the bad guy's dead, and, like, at least we have each other. Yeah. Like, Goosebumps was, like, you know, cool, scary. Are You Afraid of the Dark? The end was always like, and then they both died and went to hell. And, like, there was never a positive resolution.
I never understood why it was on Nickelodeon. You'd go from like Legends of the Hidden Temple to Rugrats to Are You Afraid of the Dark?
Yeah.
Was there like a doll or something like
yes.
that?
Yes.
There's like an attic, yeah.
Okay.
Like that was probably like the birth of my fandom of horror. Yeah.
1,000. If you were like me and Steve were changing the channel, so like I just had no interest in Are You Afraid of the Dark. You were like, I've been waiting all day.
Yeah. Like, I think what it was that it freaked out my sister so much that I was like, if she doesn't like this, then I have to like it. Like, if I want to scare my sister, then here we go. Like, Are You Afraid of the Dark? Here we go. And I just became a horror fan from there.
Tracks.
I feel bad for you guys.
Why?
You missed a lot of really great Nickelodeon shows.
Wait. Yeah, no, we had literally the golden era of Nickelodeon.
Drake and Josh, Zoe 101, Big Time Rush, Victorious, iCarly, suck it. Get the fuck out of here. Oh my God.
Those shows suck.
All those shows for sure suck. Like, what are we talking about? No, they suck, dude. You didn't have a single cartoon. That's how I know it was Basura when you were watching.
That just confirmed our era was so much better. I was like, those all suck.
Yeah. They'll never grow up like us. They'll never make them like
us. Hey Arnold, do you know the pilot to Hey Arnold, Tyler, you stupid fuck? They break up and intercept a drug deal while dressed as fruits in downtown New York. These are third and fourth graders, Milliken. Do they do that on iCarly, or was she just some sort of internet prostitute?
We wouldn't be doing this shit right now without iCarly. iCarly was like what taught our generation the internet for us young kids about what was possible content creation wise.
We were
on
already
the
on there.
No.
Not to terrible. The level iCarly was. Jake, you grew up in the same generation. Talk about what iCarly means to you.
It was a good show, but I wouldn't say we wouldn't be doing a pod without it.
Oh. Bro, iCarly
had the first pod ever. Dude,
they were doing video shows, like full blown. Great pieces of work. One Direction was
Soldier Boy was doing that at least 10 years before iCarly.
Yeah.
It was following up that era, bringing it to the young generation who didn't know yet.
iCarly. Where would Section 10 be without iCarly? We've been saying it since wouldn't the jump.
Yeah. We'd be lost.
Just wouldn't be here.
SpongeBob is ours, right?
We can play that SpongeBob. Came. The first episode was 99, wasn't it?
Yeah.
Okay, 98.
I think we all got him. I think we all got Bob.
We all got Bob.
Yeah. But to you just disrespected him naming all those swill shows before him.
What was that robot, Jenny? You guys know what? My Life as a Teenage Robot, Jake?
No.
Shouldn't be in the conversation.
I was trying to go with her like crazy, bro. I was all about her. She was the one I wanted.
That alas?
Yes, all of it.
No.
What's up, Jenny?
Yeah, I mean, we just had it great. We had it great.
Hey Arnold.
SpongeBob debuted in 99.
Yeah, that's what I thought. Hey Arnold.
Hey Arnold was so good.
The Christmas episode. Anything involving Mr. Wynn. His room. Mm. Just his room alone. Really the James Bond of our time when you start to break down Arnold Shortman.
Yeah. Yeah.
Very odd
debating.
It's fine.
Bangers.
It was fine.
Bangers.
No.
Osmo and Wanda.
It was fine.
Was that Cartoon Network?
No, it was
Nickelodeon,
but it was fine. Nickelodeon. It was just fine.
That showed me how a man and woman should be with each other. What a good marriage looks
like.
What about
Danny Phantom? Stew, Pickles, and Dee Dee, yeah.
Their kids were a disaster. You see all the issues they had going on?
They were infants.
No.
Patty Mayonnaise.
Yeah. Underdeveloped for a long time.
They were all super fucking independent.
Right.
In putting themselves in dangerous situations.
That they escaped routinely.
Every time.
Very lucky.
Never ran into too much trouble.
What was Tommy's little brother, Dill?
Yeah,
no,
Dill Pickles.
That was the other one.
No, you're right.
No. Yeah. Well, oh, yeah. He was apt. That dude
Dill
brain never developed.
Dill wasn't with us in the gym, though.
No, he was
so what?
Part of the movie rollout.
Yeah.
Dude was lacking brain cells.
Yeah.
I'm just saying Chase and Zoe, to watch that relationship develop, that was romance. That played with my heart.
No. What about Doug and Patty?
Yeah, you got to factor in Patty Mayonnaise here. Yeah. That was true love.
Mm-hmm.
Didn't do much for me.
What?
Sorry. You guys had the Wild Thornberries, right? That's your era?
Mm-hmm. Yeah,
Wild Thornberries. It, but yeah.
That show gave me nightmares. I didn't like that one.
Show's awesome. You can talk to animals.
Avatar The Last Airbender we had? Are you fucking kidding me? A cult classic?
Never heard of it.
You guys are uncultured, man.
No, I've heard of Avatar. I just prefer the shows I watched.
Still doing remakes to this day.
Helga's Shrine for Arnold.
Right. Yeah, you talk
you got to factor that in here.
You talk actual
one eyebrow.
Mm-hmm.
Big Bob Pataki would yeah, beat the shit Bob's beepers out of every person you've talked about. So just bam.
Hey, Luca, what are you doing up there? He got so mad all the time.
Bludgeon them into the ground.
What do you know? What do you know about Big Bob's beepers, Tyler?
I don't know much. I'm not
brother, he was driving an SUV around Brooklyn. Like, what? An actual lunatic.
Yeah. What was it, PS102?
That was like 118.
118?
Can't remember.
It was one something.
Definitely. Yeah, 118. Where fucking did... drilled it.
There you go. Well, you had like that like streaming service that had all these shows on it.
I did. And now it's just I'm glad you remember that. I thought about that the other day. I was like, I wonder if I'm still getting charged for that clearly defunct foreign streaming service that had all the cartoons on it.
Yeah. Does Nickelodeon have a streaming service?
Yeah.
They do?
Paramount.
And they have all these shows on it.
Just hoping to time that with when he came back. Paramount, yeah.
Where they have the iCarly, the new one.
Do they have all the Are You Afraid of the Dark on there?
I've never looked for it because I'm not a sociopath. I can check.
Mm-hmm. I'll check.
I'm checking right now.
You guys, what about Unfabulous? You guys watch
what
that?
What are these words never you're saying?
What is this? You guys. Jake, Unfabulous, please. Addy please. Singer.
No.
No. Stop and Shop, look ahead. Brought to you by Stop and Shop. Head on down to Stop and Shop. Get 10 cents off your tangerines when you buy at least 5 pounds of tangerines. Only at Stop and Shop using the promo code section 10. This is a disaster of a Stop and Shop. Look ahead. There's two. Coley?
They've got 5 seasons of Are You Afraid of the Dark, which sounds like all of them.
It has to be. All right. Paramount Plus?
The very same.
All right, I'm in. Two of the three games are TBDs, so it's like we can't really even. Tyler,
Bayo and Crawford for the first two.
No fucking shit, dude.
You said two TBDs.
Yeah, for the fucking Pirates.
Oh, excuse me.
The Pirates is a TBD against Bayo. It's Bayo versus TBD. Cutter Crawford versus Mitch Keller and TBD versus Martin Perez.
Nice internet.
My internet's so I don't know what the fuck's going on with my internet today. Like I gotta clean it up. I don't know. There's nothing I can do.
Or not.
Yeah, I mean there's 2 out of 3 games are TBDs. So I'm gonna say 1 out of 3 for the Red Sox. Steve?
I'm going to go 2 out of 3 because I just want the vibes to be better for Sunday's show.
All right. Call it.
Yeah, I'm also going to go 2 out of 3 because they're back on the road where they're a lot happier to be. And because I know that, I'm going to go over to Underdog Fantasy. I'm going to open up my app. I'm going to punch in code Carabas. I'm going to punch in code SE10. I'm going to do all of these things so I can get a $100 deposit match bonus. And I'm going to absolutely hammer Tristan Casas' hires when it comes to dingers because he wants to hit them in a picturesque park. Beautiful backdrop watching it just sail the fuck out of there. And I'm going to be hammering higher on Brian Bayo's strikeouts because to my knowledge, and I haven't looked this up ahead of time, but that game will be at night.
It will be at 6:40 p.m.
Yeah. So you just got to go over to Underdog, enter code Carabas. You will put in $100. We will give you right back $100. And then you can just play some games. Like that's the one thing, especially with this season. You want to find a way to find your, like, how can I get invested in this team? Do it with your pals over at Underdog.
You should do that. We're going to be doing some cool stuff with Underdog. Promotions very soon. We were talking about that earlier today of ways that we can run some promos that have to, well, we need to wait for Tyler O'Neill to come back.
That'll help.
But we've been running some different ideas across the board on how we can get the folks at home involved with the good folks at Underdog. So I'm excited about that. Jake, what are you thinking?
They're not going to do it, but I'll take a sweep.
Okay. T-Dog?
Yeah, I think I'm going to go 1 out of 3 for the Red Sox.
Wow.
Here.
Joining me on the dark side. Wow.
Yeah, I think so. You're going to have 2 days at least. Rafael Devers doesn't sound like he's playing tomorrow at the very least, and it's probably going to be a couple days. We know we're not seeing Tyler O'Neill in this series, so the lineup you saw today, get used to it. That's what you're going to get in this series, and the Pirates have been playing good ball. You're going to go up against Mitch Keller. That's not a good time. Martin Perez is off to a good start. I don't know. I just don't love it, and I look at, like, Cutter Crawford. Is he due for a rough one at this point? He's been so dominant. He's rocking an ERA below 0.5 right now. You know, eventually you're going to kind of go in the other direction a little bit. I just feel like this is not going to be a spot where the Red Sox kind of find their legs, because they're not going to until they have a real shortstop playing there every day. You're not going to get consistent wins. I can't buy what they're doing right now. So give me 1 out of 3. I'll take the Bayo start.
Don't you think even you guys are being overly positive, not picking a sweep for the Pirates? Like, you're still even clinging on to hope that they're going to win one.
Well, I mean, Cutter is nasty, so it's like, all sure, right. But eventually he doesn't have any wins, so it's like eventually he's got to get
maybe
one, right?
He hasn't made
an 0-4-2 with no wins. Yeah, that's true. He's got to go a little deeper, but that is crazy. Yeah. Like, is it going to be Uwasawa or is it going to be a bullpen game?
I'd like to see Uwasawa. You know,
I guess I don't want to see him, but it's either that or an opener, and you're only going to drain the bullpen more at that point. I think O'Neill Cruz is going to hit a bomb, though.
Probably.
That will make me feel a little something. Not a bunch of happiness, but it'd be cool.
Depends who it's off of.
Mm. Yeah, all right. I don't need a Kenley bomb.
Big boost. Any final thoughts, anybody? Steve?
Weather look ahead, brought to you by Billy's Gummy Bears, Jared. Mm-hmm.
Yep. You chew them with your mouth.
Chew them with your mouth. Friday night, 6:40 p.m. Eastern start. 62 degrees. It's going to rain during the day, but shouldn't rain during the game. Northwest winds at 9 miles an hour. Saturday, 4:05 start in Pittsburgh. What a beautiful park that is. 55 degrees, partly cloudy. 4% chance of rain Saturday. Looks like a pretty solid one. Might get a little cooler as the game goes on. Sunday, best weather day of the whole series. 1:35 Eastern, pushing 60 degrees at first pitch. It's not going to rain. Should be a pretty clear series in terms of rain Friday through Sunday in Pittsburgh. That'll do it for the weather look ahead, brought to you by Billy's Gummy Bears. Chew them with your mouth.
Love that. Jake's takes.
Just one more quick shout out to Paramount Plus and Hulu and HBO Max and just great streaming services.
Dependable, reliable. Right. That's what I like about them.
All right, we'll see you guys on Sunday. Bye-bye.
Buenas noches, amigos.